This is TNT Sports.
This is the Discover Car Countdown to Green as we get ready to go racing.
The Richmond International Raceway in Virginia. Never has a short track seen a bigger night. 15 drivers with the hope of capturing NASCAR's gleaming new Nextel Cup. Past champions driving toward the future, and future champions driven by the past. Tonight, above the roar of the cars, you will hear the pounding heartbeat of the drivers. The countdown to dreams is about to begin.
Tonight on TNT, a race of epic proportions. Tonight, the hopes of entire clans rest in the hands of a chosen few. Tonight, gladiators race behind the strength of their powerful horses, fueled by honor and the desire to be champion. Tonight, a race that will determine the destiny of its competitors, rewarding the victors and banishing the defeated. Tonight, there can be only 10. Tonight, there is no tomorrow.
TNT Sports presents the Chevy Rock and Roll 400, the final stop in the race to the chase for the Nextel Cup. A new season and a new championship format, christened and critiqued in February, it has become the scene stealer this summer. It is NASCAR's version of baseball's pennant race, only here there are no wild cards, just one wild night. Hi everybody, the TNT race family welcomes you to Richmond. I'm Bill Weber. When the checkered flag falls tonight, be in the top 10 in the championship standings or within 400 points of the leader, and you get to race for the Nextel Cup beginning next weekend in New Hampshire. Five drivers are locked in. Two more will clinch very early in this race. That means the eight mathematically still eligible drivers are competing for just three guaranteed spots. Here is a look at the top 15 in the championship standings heading in. Again, the top five are already locked in, but keep this in mind. Johnson and Gordon control the magic 400 point mark. Sadler clinches by starting the race. Kurt Busch is a virtual lock. And from eighth place Ryan Newman to 15th place Kevin Harvick, it's just 76 points. For these guys, it is time to rock and roll. Kurt Busch simply needs to finish 42nd or better to lock in. His two wins this season have shown his muscle, but his win at New Hampshire showed his team's determination. Ryan Newman has struggled throughout the season, but rallied to finish second at Bristol and fifth in California. Newman is the defending champion of this race, hoping to secure a spot in the chase. Rookie Casey Kane is the only driver in the top 10 without a win. But since the second race of the season at Rockingham, Kane has been consistent and considered a contender. But in his only Nextel Cup start at Richmond, he finished 28th in May. Mark Martin has clawed his way from 43rd in the championship standings to 10th. He has four top five finishes in his last six races. But his bad luck this season has been staggering. Which Mark Martin will we see tonight? The Dover winner or the Lugnut loser at Michigan?
Mark Martin has made an incredible run after spotting the field 42 positions after the Daytona 500. He's now 10th in the championship standings with only 400 laps to go, Mark. It hasn't been easy getting here. It hasn't been an easy weekend. How aggressive do you race tonight?
Well, we want to go out there and squash the field. That's what we'd like to do. The Viagra team has really put together a great race car for this track. We tested well. We were really fast in happy hour, but there were some issues with the car. Starting with yesterday, an early draw worried me, but we dodged that bullet with a fast qualifying lap. But after happy hour is over, I wasn't pleased with the way the car was maintaining the speed. It was real fast, but it backed up a little bit more than what we thought we needed to. And they found a couple of things with the car that, you know, have us a little bit worried about tonight. I should know by lap 30 whether or not we're in business. But, you know, the car has shown signs of being spectacular, and we'd like to see that happen.
Mark Martin may well be the sentimental favorite. Four times he's finished second in the championship standings. All he has to do tonight is finish third or better, and he'll have another shot at his first Nextel Cup. Marty Snyder.
Matt, the man one spot ahead of Mark Martin in the championship standings, Casey Kane in ninth, despite not running well at the short tracks this year, including here in May. You need a strong night, and short tracks are not your strong suit. Are you a little nervous?
Maybe a little bit. We worked on a lot of things over the last, you know, since we were at Richmond last, and I think our short tracks are a lot better. I know I'm better with the brakes, and look forward to tonight. It's been a little nervous waiting for this race, but it's nice to get it started finally.
The math is pretty simple for Casey. Fourth or better, and he's in the chase for the championship. Dave Burns.
Ryan Newman, eighth in points, trying to stay in the chase. And, Ryan, how important was it for you guys to qualify on the pole?
Yeah, it was a good start, definitely, for the weekend for our Alltel Dodge. If we can come out of this deal with the top five, it'll answer a lot of questions, and at least for us anyway, and we can go on to the next 10 races.
He said five. If he finishes seventh or better, I know you said top five, but if he finishes seventh or better, he can lock himself into this chase and be done with it. Matt, back to you.
For Kurt Busch, the equation is simple. All he has to do, Dave, is finish 42nd or better. So do you go out tonight with a mindset of just going for the win, or do you put yourself in the mindset of the final 10, what you have to do to win the Cup?
Well, this week's no different than the rest of the weeks. So we've got to go out to try to win and gain as many points as we can. Maybe we can do 11 in a row. Maybe we'll look at the point system like we did back in 2002 and just run as strong as we can at the end. Maybe we'll come out on top. I mean, this race is no different.
This place can bite you.
It can. It can quick. And that's why we've got a car set up for a low side and the high side. It's going to be very versatile, and it's set up to where we can adjust for the nighttime as well.
He had some mechanical issues in the spring, finishing 31st. His best finish here is 8th. Bill?
Thanks, Matt, and I'm with the guy who has the easiest job in the place tonight, Elliott Sadler. All you have to do is take the green, and you're racing for the next Nextel Cup.
I tell you what, I've been racing 22 years. I've never had a week this fun or a night this fun. I'm so relaxed for tonight's race. We have one agenda, win the race. Points are no issue. We got two batteries in the car just in case so we can get started, and I'm looking forward to a great night.
In your home state of Virginia, about 90 miles from home, butterflies, exciting. What's the feeling?
Well, no more than usual. I have a lot of family and friends that always show up to come watch us race. Actually, Governor of Virginia called me this week and congratulated me from California and also wished me good luck this weekend. I got a lot of friends here, so little butterflies, but not like usual, because I know we can take a lot of chances tonight and see the win the race or you know, nothing else really matters. So it's a great feeling to have, because we know next week we got to get down to business and race for the points again. But just a beautiful night here in Virginia. I can't think of a better place to be after clinching the championship and also winning a race last week.
Clinching a spot in the championship.
Clinching, right. I know. I want my car. As soon as we take the green, y'all move my car over there.
Don't give that away. That's later.
Oh,
that's,
I'm sorry.
Great race, though, in California where you won last week.
It was, and we needed that on this race team. We had struggled on two-mile racetracks a little bit this year, so to take a car out there and win the race like we did, that's the way we wanted to clinch a spot for tonight, right, to be able to start the race again to chase for a championship. We didn't want to go around and just ride and be finished. We want to kind of put an exclamation point on it, and we did. We carried a great car out there, and we got a few more in the shop just like it, so I'm really, really looking forward to getting started in New Hampshire next week.
And real quick, what's the tuxedo story here? You're getting one already now?
Yeah, I got a couple people calling about this. I got some buddies at Ralph Lauren are going to give me some tuxedos and stuff to try on and wear when I go to the Bank of New York. I'm excited. I've never been able to go to New York. I've watched on TV many times, so I want to go on stage. I've been a big fan of NASCAR for a long, long time in the France family, and it'll be a special honor to me to be able to go on stage and get any kind of trophy for any type of spot, but we really want that championship one, that Nextel trophy. That's what we're looking for.
Well, I look forward to that speech. Thanks for coming up here. Good luck starting the race tonight.
Thanks, Bill. Thank
Elliott Sadler starts in 20th, takes the green flag. He's in. That's the first lap. Here's what's coming up on the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Kevin Harvick hasn't won since the Brickyard 400 in August of last year. Bobby Labonte's last victory came in Homestead in November. Both need a big night to earn a seat in the championship chase. We'll talk to them. Dave discovers how the points break down and what happens if the two-point leaders break down. And Wally Dallenbach shows how to race Richmond if you want to race into the chase. All that and championship leader Jimmy Johnson coming up on the Discover Card Countdown to Green.
Good evening. I'm Jim Campbell with Chevrolet, and welcome to the 2004 Chevrolet Rock and Roll 400. Later this year, we'll introduce some new commotion to the Chevrolet family with the all-new Chevrolet Cobalt. In August, you had a chance to enter the Chevrolet Rock and Roll 400 sweepstakes to get a chance to win the car behind me, the 2005 Chevrolet Cobalt Supercharged SS with 205 horsepower. Well, tonight, I'm pleased to drop the checkered flag on the sweepstakes and announce the winner. The winner from Baton Rouge, Louisiana, is Mr. Richard Brogan. Richard, congratulations on winning the all-new Chevrolet Cobalt. Enjoy the ride, and for everybody else, enjoy the race.
Discover Card Countdown to Green. Brought to you by Discover Card. It pays to discover. And by Exxon and Mobil retailers, who wish all of the drivers a great race today.
Race fans have been talking about this night all season long. Who's going to get into the chase? Who's going to get locked out? Who's going to be mad at whom? How many guys are actually going to compete in the 10-race chase for the championship? In 400 laps, we'll have our answer. Now, Dave spent most of the day along Souvenir Alley trying to beef up his diecast collection, but right now he's going to use his findings to make some points about the points, Dave.
I know you want to have them all right now, Weber, but let me use them for examples first. The top five, they are locked in. No matter where they finish tonight, they are good for the chase. Can't get them out of there. These five down here, they control their own destiny. Elliott Sadler needs to only start the race, and he'll be okay. And short of an alien abduction between the time he talked with Weber on the wagon and the green flag, count him in. Now, 7th through 10th, take a look at them, and underneath the worst finishing position they can have and still be guaranteed a spot in the chase. Kurt Busch, he has it easiest. Mark Martin, he has a little work to do, has to finish third or better to clinch a spot in the chase. Now, the rest of these guys have to have great races, but they also have to have these guys have some problems in order to get in. 11th through 15th, they have to have good races. They need to have 7 through 10 have some bad luck in order to get themselves in there. And Bill, my biggest question, I guess, is after tonight, which ones of these are going to be more valuable? Because after the Richmond Chevy Rock and Roll 400, the die will be cast.
Very good, Dave. And it doesn't make any difference to you because you already have one of all of them. So good work on your part. Most of the guys trying to secure a spot in the chase have been saying that tonight they won't race any differently than they have all season long. And if I win a gazillion dollars in the lottery this week, I'll be sitting right here next Sunday in New Hampshire. Different strategies for different situations. Here's Wally Dolliman.
Welcome aboard my Mountain Dew car at Richmond. And we're here at the short track called the Action Track. Now, this place is short track racing at its best because it's close racing. You're bumping and rubbing, and anything can happen. Now, for the guys that are inside the top 10, like Newman, Mark Martin, Casey Kane, they're going to have to run this place aggressively, careful, because you got to run hard on a short track, but you don't want to get in anybody's mess, and you don't want to force the issue. So the guys that you're racing, you're going to have to give plenty of room, and you hope the guys around you are giving plenty of room, because all you need is a good finish, and you're in the top 10. The guys that are not in the top 10, guys like Jarrett, Harvick, Labonte, they're going to be driving tonight borderline maniacs because they've got everything to gain. So what they're going to do here on a short track is they can force the issue. They can be aggressive. They can move guys up out of the group, get some position, and that's what it's going to take. They're the hunters, and they got to go for it. They can't leave anything on the table. And what a perfect opportunity in a short track, because don't forget, anything can happen, especially those guys in the top 10. They can get caught up in somebody else's mess. So Richmond is the perfect place to set up the chase for the Nextel Cup.
Thanks, Wally. Some of the guys trying to make the chase start deep in the field. Dale Jarrett rolls off 25th, and Jamie McMurray comes from 36th. Those guys are up next when the countdown races on from Richmond, Virginia on TNT.
Jeremy Mayfield has not won in his last 142 starts. Like his teammate Casey Kane, he has used consistency to remain a contender. To race into the chase, Mayfield may need to post his first win since June 19th of 2000. Jamie McMurray is considered by many the sport's next breakthrough star, but tonight he needs to earn his stripes. Fourth at Michigan, seventh at Bristol, and fourth in California, McMurray needs another big night if he hopes to chase the championship flag. Dale Jarrett is a champion from yesterday and hopes to be a championship contender tomorrow. That depends on what happens tonight. If Jarrett makes it, he'll remember two third-place finishes at Michigan and a second at Indianapolis. If he doesn't, he'll never forget Watkins Glen.
Number one on the outsider list is Jamie McMurray, 11th in the championship standings, just 25 points stand between you and a spot in the chase for the championship. Jeremy, or Jamie, do you race the guys that you're racing in the championship, or do you worry about them, or you just go for the checkered flag tonight?
Yeah, just try to do what we've done for the last 20 weeks. Go out and try to win the race and just race as hard as you can. I think the one time you're going to see something different for our team is maybe in the last 30 if those guys have trouble and they tell you you're already in to maybe race a little bit differently, but for the most part, just go out and race as hard as you can.
A lot of work ahead tonight for Jamie McMurray. He starts 36th tonight. Matt?
Dale Jarrett has made a late-season charge, starting with that third at Chicago, 13th in the championship standings, DJ. Now, you're not wishing bad luck on anybody. But you're kind of hoping that 400-point deal comes into effect tonight.
Well, that would certainly bring a lot more people into the mix. But unfortunately, no, actually, fortunately, I just saw Jimmy Johnson and Jeff Gordon at driver introduction. So I guess nobody decided to kidnap them and help us.
You offered up your lake house.
Yeah, we were going to do whatever it would take. But now we just got to go race and race hard. And our car wasn't as good as we thought it was going to be in practice yesterday. Made a lot of changes then. We've made a lot of changes since. So we're rolling the dice, and hopefully things will go well for us. And we've got to get ourselves positioned in the top five and let everything else fall where it may.
The former series champion starts 25th tonight, but back in 1999, the year he won the title, he started 21st. Dave?
Jeremy Mayfield will try to rejoin the top 10 for the first time in four races. Jeremy, how much math have you done to try to get yourself in here? Or are you just going to race?
I really haven't done any. I know we got to come here and act like this is not even a points race. You know, we got to run up front and win the race, lead laps, and all that stuff. So I'm not even going to let it worry me. I'm just going out there and do the best we can. And whatever happens on the points just happened to us.
What number are they up to in the introductions? You need to go?
I'm about ready to
Yeah,
go.
Best good start of seventh here at Richmond. He's on the stage now, guys.
Thanks, Dave. Joe Nemechek won here in May of 2003. Tonight, he starts fourth. Jeff Burton won here 6 years ago tomorrow. Then he started third. Tonight, he rolls off fifth. The countdown continues in a moment, live from Richmond. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
Discover Card Countdown to Green. Brought to you by Discover Card. It pays to discover. And by Suzuki, maker of performance-driven motorcycles, scooters, and all-terrain vehicles.
Former series champion Bobby Labonte has slipped from fourth in the standings in June to 12th. Last week, Kevin Harvick went to California eighth in the standings and came home 15th. These two stars are clinging to hope and horsepower that this will be a memorable night in what has been an unsatisfying season.
The 29 car seems to be struggling to keep up.
Not going to be a real good points day for Bobby Labonte today. Kevin Harvick falling back, and falling back big. Bobby Labonte gets spun.
The eighth-place man in the championship just struggling.
They're going to take a hit in points.
Kevin Harvick says, horsepower-wise, we are getting killed.
Kevin Harvick may have the tallest mountain to climb back in 15th. You can coulda, woulda, shoulda, Fontana. Tonight, it's all about getting in this final race for the chase now, starting 27th. You've got your Kiss Army here. You've got to win.
Yeah, we've got Gene Simmons here from Kiss, so it's been pretty cool. Been hanging out with him, but it is a little bit of a tall order, but you can't just bow down. We've never bowed down to a fight, so get your beep button ready, because there might be some people mad, but... You know, it's Richmond, and it's typical short track race, and we're ready to go.
Now, you nearly won here before in Cup, but if you don't leave here in the top 10, how do you look back on this season?
I think you look back on it as we made a lot of mistakes, and you know, we probably didn't deserve to be in the top 10 with the mistakes that we made. So if we can put together a good night and if people have some bad luck, we'll be fine.
You never know what can happen. He's only 56 points out of the top 10. Marty?
Matt, for the first time since mid-April, Bobby Labonte is outside of the chase for the championship. 10th in the points are, you were earlier, 37 out of 10th right now. Does it give you any extra confidence you're at Richmond, one of your better tracks, Bobby?
Well, yeah, I mean, in a way it does. But also last weekend at Fontana, we always had a pretty good record there too, but it just didn't turn out that way. But Richmond's been a pretty good track for us. And you know, we sure do hope we get a good run out of it here tonight, and we need to pick up some points, and we'll give it our best shot.
He has three straight finishes of six or better here at Richmond. Bill.
Thanks, Marty. Ryan Newman in car 12 has starting position one. The pole, the same position he started from when he won his first Nextel Cup race in New Hampshire 2 years ago next week. Bobby Labonte in car 18 has starting position 18. Dale Jarrett in car 88 has starting position 25. His two wins at this track have come after starting 21st and 23rd. So on this special night, September 11th, who has the most memorable starting spot? In my opinion, it's Casey Kane, because if you take his car number and his starting spot, you get 9-11. Now, you don't have to look it up because we already did. The countdown is at zero, but there's a lot more to come from Richmond, including some pre-race ceremonies you won't want to miss.
This has been the Discover Card Countdown to Green. Let's go racing.
Jimmy Johnson comes to the checkered flag and sweeps the Pocono races in 2004. Jeff Gordon wins the Brickyard 400 for a fourth time. Dale Earnhardt Jr. wins the Sharpie 500 at Bristol. His second Watkins Glen checkered flag. Tony Stewart is the winner.
At the line by inches, it is Matt Kenseth scoring the win.
Leader Jimmy Johnson has had all kinds of offers this week. Offers not to race tonight just to tighten up the championship, but seriously, how do you keep from faltering tonight with all the chase issues swirling around you?
We just got to go out and do our job. I mean, there's a lot of hype about people maybe taking shots at us, or if we don't finish, it allows more cars into the mix. Well, you know, you can't factor in that in. We just have to go out and do our job. I really don't think that'll be the case, and I certainly hope that it's not. But we just got to go out there and keep the slowest Monte Carlo up front, stick to our game plan. What we learned tonight and how we run tonight reflects a lot of what we're going to see in New Hampshire next weekend. So we want to have a good performance here tonight and carry it over into New Hampshire.
Jimmy had his best Richmond finish of second here in May, trying to keep that championship momentum going tonight. Matt?
Dave, I've never heard more laughter surrounding the 8 car. You're locked in. You guys are having fun tonight, aren't you?
Yeah. A lot of pressure off. Just get out there and race, have fun. This is one of my favorite tracks. I couldn't think of a better place to be locked in than Richmond. So just looking forward to tonight. The car was, a little questionable in practice, but I think what we got underneath is going to be good tonight.
You wish we had more short tracks in the final 10?
I wish we ran short tracks all the time. You know, I mean, you ran a lot of them back in the old days, and we're really good on them for some reason. I used to be a bull in a china shop, but we got good on them. I guess the cars got real good, and I just keep them out of trouble. So we'll see what we got tonight.
Very good. He starts 14th, chasing his third short track win of 2004. Bill?
Thanks, Matt. Coming up next, the fans of NASCAR salute America with a moving tribute to the heroes and the memories of September 11th. You're watching NASCAR live on TNT. fans here in Richmond, and now they join the NASCAR family to salute the United States of America on September 11th. Let's go trackside.
Ladies and gentlemen, will you please rise and remove your hats and welcome Ronan Tynan for the singing of God Bless America.
While the storm clouds gather far across the sea, let us swear allegiance to a land that's free. Let us all be grateful for a land so fair, as we raise our voices in a solemn prayer. God bless America, land that I love. Stand beside her and guide her through the night with the light from above. From the mountains to the prairies to the oceans white with foam, God bless America, my home sweet home. God bless America, my home sweet home.
And now, would you please welcome once again the Secretary of Defense, the Honorable Donald H. Rumsfeld, as he leads us in the Pledge of Allegiance, to be followed by a moment of silence as we remember September 11th, 2001.
Good evening. It is a privilege to be here on this third anniversary of September 11th. And to be able to say to all of the NASCAR family and community and fans, thank you for your wonderful support for the men and women in uniform. God bless you. Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you, Secretary Rumsfeld. Ladies and gentlemen, will you please remain standing and welcome the soldiers from Non-Commissioned Officers Academy at Fort Lee, Virginia, as they proudly present our nation's colors. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Reverend Todd Comby, pastor of New Bethesda Baptist Church in Mechanicsville, Virginia, as he delivers tonight's invocation.
Will you join with me as we pray together? Our Father, we thank you on this beautiful evening. We gather for a celebration with some of the world's greatest fans of NASCAR. We pray, Lord, that this will be a wonderful night of competition. We pray for your protection over the drivers and all of the teams and all of the fans. Father, just 3 years ago, we were reminded of how tough it can be in our world. We thank you for your presence in our country. We remember the victims of 9/11. We thank you for the men and women of our armed forces as they serve faithfully even today. We thank you for your presence with us now and forevermore. It is in your holy name that I offer this prayer. Amen.
And now let's welcome Stormwatch recording artist Kylie Dean for the singing of our national anthem.
Oh, say can you see by the dawn's early light what so proud twilight's last gleaming, whose broad stripes and bright stars through the perilous fight, o'er the ramparts we watched were so gallantly streaming, and the rockets' red glare
An emotional night already underway. We join with these teams, these fans, and the entire NASCAR and salute the heroes of 9/11. While our lives race on, we will never forget them. And tonight, a reminder of our pain and our love. TNT Sports presents the Chevy Rock and Roll 400, live from Richmond, Virginia. It is NASCAR's biggest last chance race. A short list of stars and just a handful of seats left in the chase for the Nextel Cup. I gotta tell you, this place is just charged with electricity already, and we haven't even started the motors yet, but that's coming up soon. Let's send it upstairs to the three guys that get to call it all for you. Alan Bestwick, Wally Dallenbach, and Benny Parsons.
Yeah, what an atmosphere here in Richmond tonight, Bill, and we're looking forward to a great race. So eight drivers racing for three positions in the championship chase. Wally, they've been building up to this moment now for a couple of days. They've been here at the racetrack all day as they get ready to start, and as they go through the race tonight, what are they thinking? What are they feeling?
They're thinking they want to get this night over. These guys have been tore up. Their stomachs have been in knots. There's a lot of pressure, and these guys have been thinking about it. They all say, well, we're just going to go out and we're going to race and see what happens. Believe me, they're going to be thinking about it. They're going to be talking to the teams during the race, finding out where they are in that points deal, because they want to be in it bad. Tonight's the night.
Now, the eight drivers trying to lock up one of those final chase positions. That's less than a fifth of the field. BP, what about the rest of the guys? What are they thinking as this night goes on?
Well, those seven guys that already have this championship, their run for the championship locked up, they've got to go tonight and try to get run as best they can, because next week at Loudon, this thing starts to reel. They need every point they can get, so they need some momentum going into Loudon. How about those other 28 cars you asked? I'm glad I asked, because, folks, all they can do is go out on a very slick, hard racetrack and try to win this thing.
It's going to be interesting to see. And we got some guys starting in the back like Jarrett and Harvick and McMurray. If they play some pitch strategy to get to the front, we'll find out. The anticipation of this night began back over the winter when NASCAR first unveiled this chase format. A great race at a great place. Now tonight made even better by the chase for the championship. Let's get things started. Oh, the countdown was a false one. They were ready to get things started, and then they said, well, wait, we got to get that stage off the racetrack. Let's talk about McMurray and Jarrett and so on, BP. We saw in last night's NASCAR Busch Series some tire strategies that we might see these guys play in the early part of the race.
You know you're going to see that quickly tonight, because Jamie McMurray starting back, he needs to get to the front as quick as he can, and he's got a good race car.
So if we get an early caution, expect to see some of those guys take tires when the leaders stay out on the racetrack and try and get some track position a little bit later on. How about take two on that command to start engines? Let's go trackside and get the night going.
And now, race fans, please welcome once again General Motors Vice President of Global Sales, Service, and Marketing, John Middlebrook, for those most famous words in motorsports.
Good evening, fans. On behalf of Chevrolet, it's time to rock and roll. So, gentlemen, start your engines!
Needed any extra excitement, but the sound of those 43 800 horsepower engines just raised the adrenaline a whole new level here at the Richmond International Raceway. It's about time to get this show on the road. Budweiser, the official beer of NASCAR, is the proud sponsor of the Budweiser Pole Award, given to the fastest qualifier at each NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race. Ryan Newman with his fifth Bud Pole Award of the season in qualifying, putting him second to Jeff Gordon. In the season-long standings, Budweiser congratulates Ryan Newman for this weekend's race, the latest Budweiser Shootout eligible driver.
43 to start tonight's Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Mark Martin, one of the chasers, hoping to collect 5 bonus points by leading a lap early. He's on the outside of row 1.
But so does the point, the pole sitter Ryan Newman back in row 2. Jimmy Johnson next to a point leader, and Joe Nemechek, one of those 28, just wants to win.
Jeff Burton finished 4th here last September. He's in row 3 with Ricky Rudd, the 2001 race winner, has a birthday tomorrow.
Inside of row 4, Jeremy Mayfield, 55 points behind 10th, and Greg Biffle, another one of the 28, just wants to win.
Row 5, Jeff Gordon, 2 wins here at Richmond, looking to add to that total tonight, and Jeff Green driving for Richard Petty.
On the inside of row 6, Casey Kane, 9th, 34 points out of 11th, and Rusty Wallace, 6 wins on this 3/4 mile oval.
2 top 10s in his first 3 Nextel Cup starts for Carl Edwards. He shares row 7 with Dale Earnhardt Jr., looking to sweep the Richmond races in 2004.
Tony Stewart has 3 wins here. Matt Kenseth, last year's champion on the outside.
Kurt Busch, a lot of folks think he could be a threat to win this race. He locks up his chase position by finishing 42nd or better tonight at Bobby Labonte. Got to get into the top 10. He fell out last week in California.
Michael Waltrip, Elliott Sadler. Elliott, last week's winner in California in row 10.
The rookie Scott Wimmer and Bobby Hamilton Jr. going to share row number 11 tonight. It'll be Texas Terry Labonte, the 2-time champion, coming from row number 12 along with Sterling Marlin.
And back in the 13th row on the inside, Dale Jarrett has an 88 car and Brian Vickers.
Dale Jarrett, 43 points outside the top 10. There's another one of the chasers deep in the field. Kevin Harvick fell to 15th in the standings last week in California. He's got a long way to go to get to the front tonight.
Second race for Shane Mill on the outside of row 15. Inside of row 16, Kyle Petty and Kenny Schrader on the outside.
Mike Bliss driving for Joe Gibbs and David Green with his Busch Series team, Bruco Racing, in their inaugural Nextel Cup start.
And there we see Scott Riggs on the outside, Jamie McMurray. This is how far this kid has to go to try to get in the top 10 in NASCAR Nextel Cup points tonight.
And the rest of the starting field for tonight's race will tell you that Scott Riggs and Jimmy Spencer will have to drop to the end of the line. They made engine changes during the weekend. That is a violation of a NASCAR rule that only allows you one engine change or one engine to use through the entire race weekend. Final spot on the field to Kirk Shelmerdine, and there are the 43 drivers. It'll run 400 laps tonight on this very quick 3/4 mile track. Huge field of cars attempted to get into the race. And you see the drivers who failed to qualify.
Johnny Sauter was 39th fastest, only to take 38 cars on time. He was driving one of Richard Childress's cars.
And the cars continuing to warm along the pit lane. They'll be rolling out onto the speedway in mere seconds from now. Hope you got a high-def TV in your house. A high-definition production of tonight's telecast brought to you by New Line Cinemas Cellular, now in theaters. 107,097 seats here at Richmond International Raceway, including the suites and so forth, and they're all full.
Well, they're empty right now.
Because they're all standing in front of them?
Exactly.
As the field of 14. And as they complete the warm-up laps on the racetrack, let's check down on pit road where the crews make their final preparations.
As he goes for his 5th championship, Matt Kenseth rolls off 16 tonight. Now he is 5th in points. That means he has clinched a berth in the final 10 race for a chase for his 2nd Nextel Cup. Now he does have one victory here. In fact, in the last 5 races, his worst finish is 7th. But crew chief Robbie Reiser told me they were fighting like a lot of teams here in Richmond, a tight condition in the center of the corner. They made a lot of changes in that race car. It'll take 5 or 10 laps tonight to let them know if they're headed in the right direction. To Marty Snyder.
Matt, former Richmond winner Tony Stewart, starts 15th, driving the car he finished 4th with here in May. The team told me this morning they have made several small changes, trying to take what they felt like was a top 10 car and make it a top 5 or a winning car here this evening. One thing you watch out for from the 20 car tonight, Tony loves the bottom lane of the racetrack. That's where he'll stay all night long, Alan.
One of the great things about this Richmond racetrack is generally both lanes work equally as quick, but we saw in last night's Busch Series race that if a guy could make his car hug that bottom and go fast, he was going to be in fine shape.
He's going to have something going for him, because about the middle of the racetrack ended up being the fastest spot last night, and when Robbie Gordon got in the middle of the racetrack, Casey Edwards appeared to have the fastest car, could not get by him. So you've got to get to working either on the very top or the very bottom.
Yeah, don't forget, Casey Kane was working pretty good up on the top in that Busch race. So, yeah, this racetrack is a great place to see a lot of side-by-side racing, and I don't think it's going to be any different tonight.
Check out this on pit road as the cars were getting ready to pull off onto the racetrack from where they were gridded along the pit lane. Watch Shane Meal and Casey Mears. White car in the red. Whoops.
Oh, my goodness.
We had a wreck and the race hadn't even started yet.
Wow, who ever expected those guys to stop on pit road?
Look at that. Little brace, little piece of the fender. Fiberglass hanging off the back of the Casey Mears car. That shouldn't be a problem.
Yeah, that's no problem there in that 41 car.
Unless it comes off that car, then they'll have to throw a caution flag because it could puncture a tire if it should come off.
I know looking from these pictures and from up here in the broadcast booth where we can see the entire racetrack, those flash bulbs going off are just a spectacular sight. What that must be like to these already nervous drivers in their race cars.
This is one of the places where you do really notice the fans on your pace lap because it is at night, everything stands out, and you definitely see all those flashes on the cameras. It's pretty cool.
When we have the flyover tonight, when those
the cars are, when they wave that green flag, the drivers on the bubble in those positions for the championship chase, just going to be on pins and needles, just the bubble.
They're going to be sweating.
Waiting to see if an accident happens in the first few laps and they get swept up into it.
All right, folks, as we see a race analysis, check this out. Pit window, it's going to be very, very critical tonight. You know, because if they get that caution flag with about 1:35 to go, I think everybody's going to try to stop and stay on the racetrack. Track position is everything.
Been talking about it all summer. Tonight we find out who gets in and who is left out in the chase for the Nextel Cup. We're underway in Richmond as the green flag waves.
Newman got a great start. He got way up high. Robbie Gordon way up along the wall in 1 and 2 there.
Pulled it down and saved it.
Looks like he did not hit anything. I don't think he made contact with the outside retainer. Looks like he has a flat tire. Maybe just can't get back. And Jimmy Johnson already, the 48 car, going for the lead.
Now, Ryan Newman did lead that first lap. If you're new to NASCAR, the way that points are awarded in these NASCAR races, if a driver leads a lap during the night, any lap, he gets 5 bonus points toward the championship in addition to whatever he earns for his finishing position. So Ryan Newman, trying to hang on to 8th spot in his place in the chase, has already picked up 5 extra points.
And those 5 points don't sound like a lot, but tonight they are a bunch. Every single point is really important for those guys that are trying to get in the top 10.
As you watch the ticker and the running order come across the top of your screen, a couple of changes tonight from what you normally see. The drivers' names in green, like Casey Kane, are in the chase for the championship as they run on the racetrack. A driver whose name is in white is not involved in it. It doesn't affect him tonight. A driver whose name in yellow has a chance to get in the championship in this race, but if his name is still in yellow, he's not in it at this moment. So you can keep track of whether your favorite driver's making the cut or not making the cut as the night goes on.
Yes, we will be.
Yep.
I was kidding with Casey Kane. I'm sure Jamie McMurray, he's telling me how nervous he was before the race, and he said his family back home are going to watch this, and they'll be nervous as he was. I said, well, we'll keep them up to date because our ticker will be green and yellow. They'll let you know immediately. We'll let them know immediately if you're in or out.
Jimmy Johnson, the race leader. Ryan Newman, second. Mark Martin, third. Jeff Burton, fourth. Jeremy Mayfield, fifth. This a race between Ricky Rudd and Jeff Green for 8th and 9th. Green in the 43, Rudd in the 21. Riding with Joe Nemechek in the 0-1, the Army car. He runs in 7th.
Ooh, Joe got a little bit loose getting into turn 3 over there. Slid up the racetrack, lost 2 spots, maybe a third. And we saw a lot of that last night in the Busch race. We saw a lot of guys having trouble with turn 3. Getting into the corner, the cars would, it seems like they get on the brakes and the cars would jump a little bit sideways.
See Rusty Wallace moving forward in the 2 car. That's going to put Rusty up tonight. A 6-time winner here at Richmond. He could be hard to handle by the end of the night.
I'll tell you another thing we saw that we'll have to keep an eye on, BP, is
trouble turn 4. Todd Bodine. Caution flag is out. And a 1-car accident.
Right, that's what I was talking about. A lot of times you'll see guys diving down into the corner underneath somebody, and they lose that traction and slide up into another car. We saw that a lot, and that's going to happen tonight, I'm sure.
See if we can see what happened to Todd Bodine. He goes in the corner and just simply gets too high, loses traction, and when he does, that wall is right there.
Crunch. Oh, look at the bits and pieces flying off. So Bodine's on pit road, and we're under caution for the first time in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 after 8 of 400 laps in Richmond. Back in Richmond, the green flag is just waved on the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Jimmy Johnson, the leader. Ryan Newman, second. Mark Martin, third. Jeff Burton, fourth. And Jeremy Mayfield, fifth. Single file restart, so the cars spread out about a half a lap around this three-quarter mile track.
And Jeff Gordon is taking a look on the inside of Jeremy Mayfield.
That's fifth place, BP.
Did Jeremy gets the hold, gets in line.
Jeremy Mayfield outside looking in, 14th in the chase, coming in 55 points behind 10th place.
Uh-oh.
Caution,
somebody
trouble.
Around.
Turn two, Kyle Petty. So and the second yellow flag is out, which gives us an opportunity to back up to the first yellow flag a minute ago. Just a few cars pitted under that caution, among them Dale Jarrett, who gave up some track position for a stop there. Dave?
Alan, his car was so loose, he thought he might have a flat tire, so that caution was a big break for him. They changed four tires, made a wedge adjustment. He did not have a flat, just very, very loose.
So yellow out for the second time early in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. Kyle Petty outside of Kirk Shelberding going into the corner, and this is what happened.
Just a little bump, and Kyle...
Let's see how many laps of green we get this time.
Jeff Gordon jumped out there pretty quick, takes a look under Burton. Make it happen.
It's going to be for fourth place if he pulls the pass off. Jeff Burton in the 30. Marty?
Yeah, Jeff Burton came on the radio, and I've heard a lot of people talk about adding or taking out brake from the car. Jeff Burton added rear brake to the car, which means his car has been tight. He said, I turned it one turn. I think it's kind of hard to tell how much you're turning it, actually, when you're in the middle of the corner.
Yeah, adjusting the brake bias, and if you want the car to be loose going in, you put more rear brake in it. And that's going to loosen the car up going in, or if you want to go the other way, if you're too loose going in, you want the car to push or get a little, tighten it up, getting into the corner, give it more front brake. And that's one nice adjustment that you have here.
We put Kurt Busch on camera to tell you this. Todd Bodine's car has just been retired from the race. Kurt is assured of finishing 42nd or better. There is the first clincher tonight of a spot, actually the second. Elliott Sadler got one just by starting, but now Kurt Busch is assured to be in the chase for the Nextel Cup.
Ryan Newman, the 12 car, closes up on the back of the 48, and he wants back in front. Jeff Gordon, look at this 24 car. Come to the front.
And you see how Mark gave him all the room in the world, because Mark was not going to push the issue, Bill.
And they're very good. In fact, Gordon already on the radio during that caution said, this car is good, and it's real good in traffic.
And that is something that Jeff Gordon has not seen in the past couple of years, is a car good in traffic. He's really good in front, but he struggles in the back. Tell you what, these last 10 races, that's bad news for the rest of the guys. The 24 runs well in traffic.
Michael Waltrip on the move, looking for a spot on Casey Kane. Michael up to the 14th position, started back in 19th. And not able to complete the pass, he falls back in line there into the 14th spot. Casey Kane, ninth place in the championship, but just 34 points ahead of 11th, starting the race. He's in the danger zone.
This young man in this nine car has been outstanding in 2004. Hasn't won a race, but he's come awfully close. Matt?
Well, Kurt Busch has clinched a spot. Casey Kane's trying to lock down a spot as well, telling crew chief Tommy Baldwin under that last caution, the car just goes sideways when I try to get in the gas. I barely touch the throttle, and it goes sideways. I can barely turn the wheel.
And a change for second place. Gordon is rolling.
And he is. He went right by Ryan Newman. That's not easy.
And this is exactly what I was talking about in my opening tonight, is the 24-48. These guys are really getting some momentum for these final 10 races of the year.
Dale Jr. in 8, Ricky Rudd in 21, racing for ninth spot. And behind him, Casey Kane trying to move forward with Michael Waltrip in tow.
Junior takes that spot away from Ricky Rudd, but this is one of Rudd's better runs in the last couple of months. Good to see that.
That's talked to Eddie Wood, one of the team owners, earlier today. He said it's been just a remarkable change since the addition of Michael McSwain. How about that Wood Brothers car with Ricky Rudd, Matt?
And Fatback and Ricky Rudd have had a lot of success here together. In fact, Fatback told me earlier today, he says, we feel very confident about this race car. Ricky does tell Fatback, though, that the car feels a little stiff when he went to the high side. A lot of drivers wondering how long it would take before people really started working in that upper groove. And that's one thing Dale Earnhardt Jr. was wondering as well. He feels like he'll be strong up there.
I think there's a lot of guys working it right now. A lot of cars starting to go up there and test it anyway.
148 mile an hour left-hand turn for Ricky Rudd.
Seems to be working for Ricky right there.
It does, and that 20 car of Tony Stewart, if we see him on top of the racetrack, folks, in that high group, it will be a news flash. It will be a bulletin, because we very seldom see Tony run the higher line around this racetrack.
See the Air Force recruiting sponsorship on Ricky Rudd's car using the words "Let's Roll" in their paint scheme tonight. Of course, commemorating the 9/11 anniversary, the words made famous by Todd Beamer from the plane that was brought down in Pennsylvania by the passengers overcoming the hijackers, as the plane most believed destined toward Washington, D.C. Rusty Wallace moving forward, Bill.
Under the watchful eye of majority owner Roger Penske, who said on the radio, looks like you have a good car down there tonight. That's the car that Rusty took to Victory Lane in Martinsville. He wanted to bring it here in May, but they brought a different car, car 64. This car that Rusty is driving has just been sitting in the shop since it left Victory Lane in Martinsville. They dusted it off, brought it here. Rusty from 12th starting spot, moving forward.
Rusty Wallace with 21 top five finishes in 41 Richmond races. He's led over 3,000 laps here, looking to add to that total tonight. Top two in the championship, hold the top two spots in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Jimmy Johnson leading Jeff Gordon after 32 laps.
The Chevy Rock and Roll 400 on TNT is brought to you by Nextel Coast to Coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR Nextel, partners in speed. By Budweiser, it's time for a fresh one. Grab a Budweiser, the race is on. And by Chevy, the winningest name in racing, an American revolution.
There is a new Chevy leading the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Jeff Gordon has rocketed by his teammate Jimmy Johnson.
Hughes comes off turn four, makes that move to the inside, and Jimmy realizes he's a faster car, so he goes up, gives him the racetrack. You know, in the garage area, there's been a lot of kidding this week about if these cars, the 2448, were not to finish, that would bring maybe all 15 of the cars battling for the championship within 400 points of the lead.
Yep.
So they're saying, well, they've got a bullseye on the 2448. Someone is going to hit them. Hey, as long as they stay where they are, it's going to be awfully hard to hit them, you know?
Yeah.
Maybe when they lap them.
Way to stay out of the mess is to stay out front.
Exactly, and they're doing that.
Jeff Gordon, the third different leader of tonight's race. Of course, we're talking all about who's going to get into the chase. The chase begins next Sunday, 1 week from tomorrow, at New Hampshire International Speedway. And then it's on to Dover, Delaware for race two of 10 to determine who will be the champion. You'll see them both on TNT. Then it's over to NBC for Talladega. That could be a real wild card. And Kansas Speedway, October 10th. What's upcoming on the Wendy's race menu?
This thing's stays green. We were talking about during the commercial, there's going to be a lot of cars a lap down here in a hurry.
Because Jeff Gordon is flying.
Yeah, and when you have a guy like Jeff Gordon, as fast as he is on a short track, hooked up like this, boy, a lot of guys go down a lap.
Jeff about to put Ken Schrader, the 39th place car, a lap down. Then it'll be Bobby Hamilton Jr. in the 32, and who's that right in front of him there? Is that
Robbie Gordon up there?
Or
Casey Mears, Burton, yep. All right there in front of Jeff.
And not all that far ahead of where Gordon is now, you've got some guys like Dale Jarrett and Jamie McMurray, chasers. Mark falling back to fifth from second, Bill.
Yeah, might just be pacing himself early, although Mark always drives aggressive on the Discover card countdown to green. You heard him say by lap 30, I'll know how good the car is.
That's because after they finished happy hour, they found something mechanically wrong with the car. They didn't want to say what it was, but it said it left them in a very unsure position, although they felt by fixing that problem, the car would be much better. Mark tested with that car here, felt it was strong yesterday. We'll see what happens, but he has slipped back a little bit here in the early going.
Tell you what, Bill, on Lapico, he was the fastest car on the racetrack, so... You know, Mark's a smart race car driver, and he's going to pace himself, and he's in a good spot right now. I don't think he wants to get in the thick of things at the moment. So he knows what he has to do tonight.
As they run on the racetrack, Mark is, you'll see, ninth in the championship standings.
The first five cars have locked in. The first seven cars actually have locked in, and then we go back to Newman. Mark has moved ahead of Casey Kane, but now... Who's 11th? How close is he?
Mayfield up three spots right now, as is.
He runs fourth in the race, and it's that close. So Martin running in fifth. Coming up behind him, Rusty Wallace in sixth. Rusty with a strong move forward in the early laps of the race, started in 12th position.
Like I said, I think if you see Rusty get right up on the back, Mark will just let the car go. He'll do his racing later.
And for the lead, now that Jeff Gordon has gotten into some lap traffic, Jimmy Johnson is close back in.
And Ryan Newman right behind Jimmy Johnson. Now, Jimmy Johnson will cut Jeff Gordon some slack because, after all, they're teammates. That 12 car is not going to cut anybody any slack.
Great camera angle right here off the front of Jimmy Johnson's car. Right on the bumper.
Trouble on the backstretch. Got one spinning. Carl Edwards. And the caution's out. Third caution of the race. Edwards driving the 99 for Roush Racing in his fourth Nextel Cup Series start.
And he was going to lose a lap.
Sorry, man, I just lost it.
There you go.
Good break for guys like McMurray and Jarrett, who are in danger of being lapped, and I wouldn't be surprised if they hit the pits here.
Edwards was running in 17th place at the time of his spin, and you're right. I think we've run 52 laps now. I think we'll see everybody come onto pit road. Now,
except those guys that he just talked about, and they'll stay out.
Well, unless their cars are not handling, and they need to make some adjustments.
But you know, it's been a while since they pitted, though. It was lap 9.
Yeah, I bet you they're still adjusting on their cars. I think they'll be in.
All right, well, we'll find out when they open the pit lane here in a second, which will be now. We're coming down from NASCAR Race Control. The pit road is open this time. And so we'll see.
You doubt me?
We'll see.
We'll see. I base my opinions on experiences, Wally.
Okay, here we go. And Ryan Newman. No, I'm sorry, that's a lap car, isn't it?
Yeah, that's Ward Burton.
Yes, zero car stays out.
All the leaders coming in so far. Go ahead, Dave.
Jeremy Mayfield pitting, and they're going to try something. How about no tire change, fuel only for the 19 car?
Jeff Gordon on pit road, loose in, but good up off. They talked about making a chassis adjustment. Instead, it's just four tires. They come around to the left side, working on Gordon's car, then they'll send him on his way. Matt.
The 19's already off pit road. Ryan Newman was very pleased with his race car. He said he can make it both free or tight, depending on his line, his exit off turn two. Two tires for the 12.
I saw Robbie Gordon get fuel only also. We heard from Matt and from Dave. Jeremy Mayfield getting fuel only. Ryan Newman getting just right side tires. Looks like Mayfield the first off the pit lane. And we're under caution here at Richmond International Raceway. An exciting night after an emotional pre-race. Caution here at Richmond gives us time to give you our NASCAR Busch Series update. Robbie Gordon with his first Busch Series win last night. He went from third to first with 15 to go when Martin Truex slipped into Casey Atwood racing for the lead. Truex gaining a little ground on Kyle Busch in their championship duel, the NASCAR Busch Series at Dover, 1 week from Saturday. Craftsman Truck Series raced here at Richmond on Thursday night. Ted Musgrave won, leading all but 10 laps for his second win of the year. Bobby Hamilton holding a slight championship lead over Dennis Setzer and Carl Edwards. Trucks race at New Hampshire International Speedway next Saturday.
Okay. Thanks for that update.
It's my job.
Thank you.
I was surprised that all the cars did make a pit stop besides Mike Wallace, the 09 car. He stayed on the racetrack. Now, 19, he played the track position game by fuel only in the 12 car right sides. See how that works out.
Well, like I said, I think some of those guys probably would have stayed out, but I think they're still fighting ill-handling cars. So they're making all the changes they can under the caution, especially early in the race.
Sorry, Wong, cars on the inside are a lap down to the race leader. Bobby Hamilton Jr., 32, trying to stay in front of Mike Wallace. He'll put caution and come back around and rejoin that lead lap.
Oh, Bernie Mayfield all over the back bumper of Mike Wallace, that 09 car.
Don't forget, as you watch the ticker at the top of the screen, the cars whose driver's names are listed in green are in the chase for the Nextel Cup at this moment. White, out, not affected. Yellow, the guys who still have a chance at getting in but are not inside the top 10 at this point in the race. See Jeff Gordon doing some bobbing and weaving in traffic. Around the lap car of Carl Edwards, the 99. And Gordon running in fourth, trying to catch Ryan Newman in the 12 for third.
And you know that the 19 car, Jeremy Mayfield, wants to lead a lap so bad he can hardly stand it. Get those five bonus points, but Mike Wallace pretty strong in that 09 car. Dave, what are they saying in the 19 camp?
Yeah, I mentioned they were trying something by not taking on tires there. It's actually based on fact. They tested here 2 weeks ago, and it was all about tires. They did long runs, learned how to make the car not wear the tires. They confirmed it yesterday in happy hour. They ran the entire happy hour on one set of tires.
Casey Kay, Mayfield's teammate. Big slip off of turn number two. He's lost a whole pile of positions in this last lap, falling all the way back to 23rd place from 16th.
Mayfield's working him.
He's trying his best. Can he lead a lap?
No. Not that time.
All he's got to do is get to the start finish line. He'll get those five bonus points.
He drove in hard that time. Mayfield. Got a little bit of an edge. And here's where the guy on the outside seems to look like he's got 50 more horsepower when they come off of turn two. The guy on the outside always seems to have the advantage.
We'll try him again. Not this time. Mayfield starting the race 14th in the championship, 55 points behind 10th place Mark Martin.
Here comes the bump.
Because he sees that 24 car coming fast.
If he's going to lead a lap, he's going to have to get it done because the 24 is going to get by the 19 in no time. Bill.
Wally, Jeff Gordon's got a great seat for that battle, but before they went back to green, crew chief Robbie Loomis warned his driver in that 24 car, long way to go, be careful with those guys in front of you.
Try to be careful, but you know when you got a good car, the best thing to do is get them behind you.
I think Robbie's been listening to all those conspiracy theorists in the garage area.
You think? So Mike Wallace leads, Jeremy Mayfield is second, Jeff Gordon now third. Ryan Newman fourth, Rusty Wallace fifth.
I'll tell you, it was a different atmosphere, though, in the garage today. With you, like, around the 24 bunch, talking to Robbie, those guys were loose and having fun. Yet, if you went over to, like, McMurray or one of those cars that were still fighting for it, you could cut the tension with a knife around that garage stall.
I thought it's the last couple of weeks, the atmosphere in the garage has been extraordinary.
Yeah, it really has.
I mean, it's just like the final race of the season. I mean, it's the final race to qualify for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship. And after this, these guys got 10 races just like this.
And they got to do it every week.
Every week. Matt.
BP now, the 9 car, which you saw earlier, was in the green. He has dropped all the way back to 26. He finally came on the radio two laps ago and said, Tommy, this car is really, really loose on low air pressure.
And so what that means for Casey Kane by falling back to where he is on the racetrack in 26th place, he has fallen as they run outside the top 10.
And what they're trying to do is they're trying to, what Tommy's doing is trying to get that car set up for the real long runs. The problem is if the car is really, really bad on the first 10 or 15 laps when you have the pressures down, you lose so much track position that it doesn't pay itself off.
So Kane out, kicks Mayfield in. for now. And look down below, 11 through 15. Kevin Harvick moving up nicely in this race. Kevin is all the way up to 13th place. He started back in 27th.
And Harvick's one of those guys that he really can't worry about it. All he's got to do the best he can. Uh-oh, we got trouble up in turn three. Robbie Gordon just sliding like crazy.
No caution.
I'll tell you what, he has almost hit the wall about three or four times already tonight.
I locked up my left front really bad.
He locked up his left front really bad with brakes.
So what he's got to do is he's going to have to dial some of that front brake out, dial it to the rear, balance it a little bit better. But he took off up the racetrack.
And now look at the suit this puts Casey Kane in. And he fell back, and Robbie Gordon fell back and kind of bottled up traffic, trying to gather up his car. Casey Kane on trying to stay in this chase for the Nextel Cup, and he's right in the middle of a heavy pack of traffic.
And back to the lead. Jeremy Mayfield still trying his best to get by Mike Wallace. Can't do it.
Mike's doing a good job.
He's doing a fantastic job. That car ran well in practice yesterday.
And that's how much, right there, this is how important track position is. You see, we never even know where Mike was before that caution, but he stayed out. He's got a, you know, a pretty good race car, and he's staying up front. These guys have been going at it really, really hard. Case Kane, Robbie Gordon. They've been banging off each other the last couple laps.
I think it's going to be one of those nights where your head's going to be on a swivel, trying to figure out where to look and what's the biggest implication happening at the moment. You know, there's just things going on all the way through the field. Let's check on Casey Kane some more, Matt.
Alan, all year long, this young man, he's had to change his goals after each part of the season, and he continues to impress everyone. Coming into today, the nine guys, they really felt like they had a good shot to lock in a top 10. Rodney Rhodes, a gas man, told me, only once a year do I get goosebumps on race morning. It's usually the Daytona 500. Today, I couldn't sleep. I woke up with goosebumps. This race is huge for these guys. He's trying to work his way slowly back to the front.
And his teammate Jeremy Mayfield still unable to work his way around Mike Wallace and collect 5 bonus points toward the championship. Lap 76 complete. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
The TNT race family rocking and rolling at Richmond International Raceway in Virginia. 107,000 fans still watching this battle as Jeremy Mayfield works and works and works on Mike Wallace, but he hasn't gotten past him yet. So Mike Wallace leads. It's time for a visa through the field. We'll start with a 0-9 car, and that means Dave Burns bats leadoff.
And Wallace feeling as much heat as he has so far from Jeremy Mayfield right now. Decided to stay out and lead some laps, a good idea. First lap's led this year for Mike Wallace, and he's doing a good job. Mayfield pressuring in second. They've been surprisingly quiet on the radio. Jeremy not getting all upset. They wondered if the 09 would work for him and let him lead a lap. It didn't happen. Bill?
Well, Jeff Gordon in that 24 car running third, but you're not going to believe this. A few laps ago, he said, loose, loose, loose. Last lap he goes, and now I'm getting tighter. The push is bad, too. So the 24 car starting to lose the handle, Matt.
Back in May, Ryan Newman fought a tight race car for the first half of the race before they finally dialed it in tonight. It was a little tight earlier, but the two tires in the last stop, Ryan telling Matt Boylan the car is very good.
Rusty Wallace's crew chief, Larry Carter, on the two car told me this afternoon on a scale of 10, that car is a 9.5. Rusty on his first stop, 4 tires, no changes. Marty.
Kurt Busch really moving up through the field. Bill, he did start 17th tonight. Currently, he is in the 6th position. The car is excellent. Loose in and off last time. They made an air pressure and track bar adjustment, Bill.
Boy, Mark Martin in the 6th car, very quiet. He's so strong. I bet when this race is over, he's so determined that steering wheel's probably bent or folded over. Hasn't said much since his first stop. They did make some changes on that stop, though. They made a wedge adjustment to try and help Mark's car, which was just getting a little loose. Matt?
Right before the lap 53 pit stop, Jimmy Johnson told Chad Knaus, the loose on entry is going away. Now it's just way too tight through the center. He also made a note that he wasn't using as much brake as he thought, but Chad did say, I can see the rotors are glowing. Take care of them. Meanwhile, driver 8, Dale Earnhardt Jr., no adjustments on the last stop. He told his team he's very happy with the race car, trying to sweep both races at Richmond in 2004, Marty.
Matt,
rounding out the top 10 is Jeff Burton, who started fifth tonight. His car was tied earlier. We talked about him adding the rear brake. That made the car too loose. On the last stop, they also went down on the track bar. Too loose for Jeff Burton in the 30 car, Alan.
Those the top 10 of 37 cars that are on the lead lap. Four drivers have led tonight. Jimmy Johnson, Jeff Gordon, Ryan Newman, and Mike Wallace, who continues to hold off Jeremy Mayfield for the lead. We continue going through the field with 11th place, Jeff Greenville.
And the famous 43, and how many times have we seen that number running up front at Richmond? Jeff Green in that car tonight, driving for the king, Richard Petty. Car's just a little too tight. They made a small wedge adjustment to four tires on their first stop. As for the 20 car of Tony Stewart, the car was tight before the last stop. But let's go back upstairs. Now, what's going on up front?
I thought Jeremy Mayfield had Mike Wallace, Bill.
Everything's going to look like Jeremy had him and behind him, around him, and I thought he had Jeff Gordon, but we're still back the same way.
I'll tell you what, I'm very impressed with how Jeremy's been racing Mike Wallace. These guys have been racing this close, this hard, and Jeremy has raced it very, very clean up to this point.
Jeremy took a look on the outside a couple of laps ago. Man, how did he stay out of that left rear?
This every lap.
That's good stuff. I tell you, it's why this racetrack is so popular. Two grooves all the way around, equally as fast as the other. It's hard to finish a pass here. While we keep an eye on that for you from up here, let's go back down pit road and continue going through the field. How about Kevin Harvick, Dave?
Checking in on him. He started the day 27. Car was generally good at the start of the race. They pitted for four tires and made no changes to the chassis. Right now, just a little bit loose in and tight off the corner. Marty?
Dave, at one point in this race, the 17 car Matt Kenseth was 36th. Now he's 13th. Their last pit stop, 12.87. He came in early, so the car was so loose, he couldn't drive it. They've made it much better.
Marty, back in May, Michael Waltrip scored his best career in Richmond, finished at 10th. He was working on another top 10, but now the car, like it was the first run, is starting to go back to the tight side.
The progress for Bobby Labonte, the 12th place man, the championship, Matt, is slow and steady in the blue and yellow car, number 18. He was had no grip on the last stop. They have pound out of all the tires, but he likes the feel of his tires. They are scuffs, Matt.
The 16 of Greg Biffle, no grip, fighting a really bad loose race car and air pressure, track bar and wedge adjustment. A lot of adjustments trying to dial that race car back in, Marty.
Matt, last time Elliott Sadler was loose in and loose off. They went down the track bar. Now it's too tight in the middle. He said put the adjustment back, but the times have picked up for the 38 team, Matt.
Ricky Rudd telling Michael Fatback McSwain he feels like the brake bias, there's something amiss. He said it feels like all he has rear brakes, and then it pushes up off the corner. Meanwhile, Casey Kane slowly making his way back into the top 20. This young man on a heck of a drive, working on the inside of the 21 of Ricky Rudd. Dave?
Scott Wimmer running where he started the day, 21st. They made a two-tire change on the last stop. His car was a little bit loose from the center off. Really hasn't gone anywhere at this point, Matt.
And Terry Labonte in the 5 car. We've got a battle for the lead, guys.
And Jeremy Mayfield led a lap. How about that?
5 bonus points. He finally got the nose under Mike Wallace and got the runoff turn 4. And he had better go to that lead now because there's a new third place runner and closing quickly.
There's a new gunman in town. Kurt Busch, the 97 car, is coming back.
While we've been doing through the field, Kurt has passed both Ryan Newman and Jeff Gordon. He's third and closing. And closing in a big hurry. Boy, imagine what locking up that spot early in the race does for your freedom to go race for the win.
Absolutely, and believe me, I bet you within a lap, he knew.
And the best part, Jimmy Finning told me, this is exactly the way we're going to race tonight and the next 10 races. Right, Marty?
That's right, BP. I think that's called going for it. And what Jimmy told me was they really wanted to win tonight to build momentum for the next 10 races. He said, we can't experiment. We can't rest on what we've done so far this season. We must win because we know we can go to New Hampshire and win, and there's no better way to start the chase for the championship. Kurt, very happy with the car. Obviously, it's very, very fast. And Jimmy just came over to me and said, watch this. He's going to go to the front, and he's doing it.
I guess. Got to give a lot of credit to Mike Wallace not pitting on that last caution and holding off all these guys on fresher tires and holding off Jeremy Mayfield for the lead for so long. Nice job.
And that's telling all these guys that these tires on the car tonight are very good. They'll run for 100 laps, 125 laps. So at the end, for that track position, they get 125 to go. These guys will be staying out.
Yeah, and Mayfield didn't get tires, right?
No, that's right.
Yep.
Now, two other cars that we did not get to update through the field because they weren't running in the top 22 or so that we got to, that are in the chase. Jamie McMurray and Dale Jarrett are trying to get into the chase anyway. McMurray's 26th, Marty.
And he started 36, Alan, so he's only gained 10 spots. You see a little right front fender damage from some contact earlier. The car is loose in, tight in the middle, and loose off. That's how it was under the first set of stops. They made an adjustment, did not fix it, not as fast, not as much progress as Jamie McMurray, the 11th place man in the championship, would have liked. Dave?
Dale Jarrett's day not going well. Started 25th, fell back to as far as 35th. Restarted this last time in 30th and has only picked up a couple of spots. I just checked with the crew. He hasn't said anything on the radio. The car was tight earlier. Just not handling for DJ right now.
Yeah, it's not going well. So that's the story on McMurray and Dale Jarrett, whose efforts to get into the chase are floundering here tonight. New second place runner, Kurt Busch, just around Mike Wallace, and he finds himself just over 1 second behind Jeremy Mayfield.
He could get there in a hurry, too, because he's about 3/10 of a second last quickly.
And we're just past a quarter distance in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 at Richmond. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
The Chevy Rock and Roll 400 on TNT is brought to you by Chevy, the winningest name in racing, an American revolution. By Goodyear Assurance, featuring triple tread technology. And by Miller, who reminds you that there's good enough and there's better than it has to be. Miller, good call.
2 liter in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. As expected, Kurt Busch has completed his charge up and around Jeremy Mayfield to the top spot.
Tell you what, this 97 car is just outstanding tonight.
Happened about a lap and a half ago, heading down into turn number one.
Yeah, the slower traffic of Robbie Gordon came into play on that one. Mayfield got boxed in behind him, and 97 car of Kurt Busch took advantage of it.
So Kurt Busch becomes the fifth different driver. Check out the sixth different driver to lead this race tonight. And goes out in front at lap number 115. Marty?
Mr. Busch is rolling to the front, Alan, and lead now at lap 117, as you said. And you think these drivers, they may downplay it, are not focused on the chase for the championship. Kurt Busch immediately wanted some information on where he was in the chase for the championship.
Got anybody out of the race yet?
They will be thinking about it all night long. And here, there's a happy camper right there, because he doesn't have to really think about it anymore. It's done. He's in.
Kurt Busch's best finish here at Richmond in eighth place in the May race of 2003. And he is in pursuit of what would be his third win of 2004 in tonight's race.
Shane Buell, the 23 car, currently in 31st position, going a lap down to Kurt Busch.
Our Miller Lite NASCAR Nextel Cup race facts. Looking back on a variety of people who've been to Victory Lane here in Richmond in this September race. 10 different winners in the last 10 Nextel Cup fall races here at this track. Dating back to Terry Labonte's win in 94, it's been Terry, Rusty Wallace, Ernie Irvin, Dale Jarrett, Jeff Burton, Tony Stewart, Jeff Gordon, Ricky Rudd, Matt Kenseth, and Ryan Newman.
So he could make it 11 in a row, could Kurt Busch?
He could. He's got a long way to go.
Yes, he does.
So Jeremy Mayfield shuffled back to second place, Dave.
Hey guys, one of the groups that's under pressure tonight are the pit crews for the guys that are trying to get into the chase here tonight. This 19 crew had some trouble last week and admitted to it. When I talked with them earlier today, they said they practiced every day this week, did 4 or 5 stops in the evening, and slowed down. They were all jacked up last week. That felt that cost them. So they slowed down their stops, busted off some really good stops, and just made sure that they hit everything right. That first stop was very good for them. And they planned, and obviously they didn't change tires in the first stop, but even that was good for these guys to get them back in the game on pit road.
Yep, David, you know what? These teams, the further we go on in the race, the more important the pit stops become and the more pressure on those crew guys. So really, those last couple of pit stops, those are the ones that are really going to count tonight.
And we saw Kenny Francis, Jeremy Mayfield's crew chief, make the call for no tires on that first pit stop. When we get inside of the final 200 laps, down around that 150 to go mark, and the caution comes out, the pressure is really going to be on some of these crew chiefs for the right strategy call. If they make the wrong call, and get their guy hung in the back of the pack and he can't make up the ground, they could lose a shot at the championship from everything they've worked for all season.
And he hasn't changed tires yet, talking about the 19 car. And guess who had the fastest lap last lap? Jeremy Mayfield.
So that's really going to have some crew chiefs stewing over their decisions later. Kurt Busch out in front at lap 125 of the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 from the sold-out Richmond International Raceway. TNT Sports live in Richmond, Virginia with the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Series, the race that will determine which drivers will compete in the chase for the Nextel Cup. Kurt Busch, the race leader, one of six drivers that have paced this event. He's out in front of Jeremy Mayfield, the second-place driver, by 0.7 seconds, with Ryan Newman, now Matt Kenseth, and Jimmy Johnson making up the rest of the top five. Here is our Singular Wireless Race Talk poll for tonight. When you get the stat books out for these racetracks and you go to a short track, there are always this whole column of statistics for short tracks. None of these drivers has ever won a short track race in the Nextel Cup Series. They've won before. Well, Casey Kane hasn't. But they've not won a short track race either. Which one will get one first? Dial us up, cast a vote.
Okay.
Got your pick? All right, Matt Kenseth starting to roll toward the front, Marty. He started back in 16th place.
Yeah, Alan, and at one point was 36th in the race. It's never a good idea when you want to pit at lap 9, but Matt Kenseth said, we have to pit now, guys. And that's been the key to their resurgence. They made several changes. The car was so loose, Matt said, I can't drive it. Now, the car, excellent. He said, it turns in the middle great. We're very good there. I think we're going to be excellent on the longer runs. Matt?
Jimmy Johnson just dropped back to fifth, 5.8 seconds out of the lead. His car tight, chattering the left front in the entrance of the quarters. Now every lap that Jimmy completes tonight will help the hurricane victims of Charlie and Francis. It's the Racing for Relief program that began back in April of 2000. Jimmy has helped raise more than $350,000. And with Hurricane Ivan on the way, he couldn't pick a better weekend to continue the program.
Yeah, that's for sure. Our thoughts certainly with all of those down in Florida and the hurricane and storm affected areas. Spent a little bit of time in Daytona Beach this week personally and got a firsthand look at some of the damage that Francis and Charlie did there. And certainly our hearts go out to those affected.
The camera you saw just a moment ago was the front bumper of Jimmy Johnson as he tries to get by the 12 car. Ryan Newman could not quite make it. 17 cars marched by both those.
Boy, Kenseth's doing what Kurt Busch did just a little while ago.
Yes, he's marching his way to the front.
Mark Martin settling back in eighth place, Bill.
Yeah, not really going the right way, but still hanging inside that top 10. The problem is the car is just too tight. They're going to go back to the way it was before they made the adjustment. So they're going back to their original setup. That's 1 to 1.5 rounds out next time they stop. Snyder.
Marty.
Hello.
There you go.
Bill Bobby Labonte is in the ninth position now. His car has really come to life. They have put scuffed tires on the car, tires that have been run through a couple of laps. Bobby wants more of that. The car's really gotten a lot better since they did that. He is currently in the ninth position. Before he got in the car, Bobby told me that this is a racetrack where they can finish in the top 10. For us, that would be like a win. They haven't had one of those in the last 8 races.
And an important note in the championship, for those pursuing that top 10, notice that leader Kurt Busch has just passed both Dale Jarrett and Jamie McMurray.
Wow. So their battle is...
Caution is out.
Well, one of those guys will get it back.
One of those guys is going to be the lucky dog.
McMurray.
Caution for something in turn two.
What, Mike Wallace, the 09 car, gets a terrible, terrible break. He had stopped on the green and changed tires and is now caught a lap down.
NASCAR confirming that Jamie McMurray will be the lucky dog. Apparently somebody brushed the wall and has dropped some debris.
I think it may have been, well, I'm not sure who it was, but they're saying the 99. I saw the 4 car, Jimmy Spencer, bounce off the turn 2 earlier too. They're saying Carl Edwards maybe.
So lucky for McMurray, not so lucky for Dale Jarrett.
Well, he's up there, but he hasn't hit the wall yet.
Never hit it. No.
Some stuff flying up when he got up there by the wall, but now here
They're sending one of the cleanup trucks out to pick up a screwdriver also that's on the racetrack.
Oh, no, I didn't see the screwdriver come out of that 99 car.
No. All right, pit stops. Lap 143, Dave.
What is supposed to be a routine pit stop for Jeremy Mayfield, Dana Worthing, and Mike Jansen of the tire changers. No changes to the chassis, just five lug nuts off and five lug nuts on all the way around, and fuel for Jeremy Mayfield. Marty?
Dave, leader Kurt Busch says the car is starting to get a little bit tight, needs some more rear end grip. So what they're going to do, go down one round on the track bar, half pound on left side tires, Bill.
It is a wedge adjustment for the six car, Mark Martin. The car is just too tight. They use the air hose to blow the brake dust off the lug nuts so they can see four tire change to match.
Bill, a wedge and track bar adjustment already completed on Ryan Newman's Dodge as the 19 and 97 are away. And it's a close call off of the 48 to 2.
First off pit road, Jeremy Mayfield.
And those guys didn't do a good job last week in California. Looks like practice does make perfect.
They made up for it.
Man, look at this.
Great pit stop.
Terrific.
Mayfield, Kurt Busch. Waiting. There we go. There's Ryan Newman, Matt Kenseth. And that close race Matt described will give Rusty Wallace the edge there over Jimmy Johnson. So yellow flag number four out in tonight's Chevy Rock and Roll 400. A tough night for Dale Jarrett, who finds himself now trapped a lap down by the caution flag. Jeremy Mayfield led earlier to get those five bonus points. Kenny Francis, Sammy Johns, the gentleman in the red shirt, cheering on as his team gets the race off pit road done quickest. The 33rd NASCAR Nextel Cup Series race on this three-quarter mile layout at Richmond International Raceway. They've been racing here on the property since late 1946. Started as a half-mile dirt track, became a half-mile paved track, and then in 1988 made into the beautiful shape that it is tonight. And on over which the green flag is waved.
Here's where it's good to clear those cars a lap down more, BP, because now Jeremy Mayfield and Kurt Busch can get away from some of those guys behind him that have to fight those cars.
And I tell you what, Jeremy Mayfield's crew will look at those four tires they took off that 19 car. He might have just changed tires for the last time out on that 19.
Mayfield leads, Kurt Busch second, Ryan Newman third, Matt Kenseth fourth, Rusty Wallace fifth. Rest of the top 10, Jimmy Johnson, Mark Martin, Earnhardt Jr., Harvick, and Jeff Burton. Bobby Labonte is 11th, Jeff Gordon 12th, Casey Kane 16th, Elliott Sadler 19th, Jamie McMurray 22nd, and Dale Jarrett, first car one lap down, 25th place.
As you see the positions go across the top of your screen, don't forget, if the name is in green, he is qualified. He's in for the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. Yellow, still pending. White, they're out.
I like that, pending. Scott Riggs. The 10 car is a couple of laps down in 30. I've got a car up, dusting off the upper lane.
Terry Labonte.
Stay under green, all clear. And Rusty Wallace right in the thick of this race for a top five spot, Bill.
And had a good stop on pit road, 13.92, four tires, and a wedge adjustment was just a little tick tight. And for Rusty, you know those measurements are microscopic. So we'll see how this one helps. Matt, how about the 48?
Having a very solid run, currently in the sixth position now under that last pit stop. Chad Knaus made some significant adjustments to the 48 car. Down on the track bar, and also an air pressure adjustment. Jimmy said, whoa, 88 guys.
Dale Jarrett.
Four wide.
Remember I told you about those guys driving borderline maniac?
Yep.
That's what the 88 is doing right now.
Well, Dale Jarrett desperate to stay the first car one lap down in case the caution comes out. That run up the hill, though, has cost him the spot when Sterling Marlin got by him in the 40.
He has been forcing the issue there.
He was trying to keep David Green in the 27 car behind him because, as Alan said, to be the lucky dog. And while they were contesting that, Sterling Marlin trolled by.
So the night continues to be a struggle for former champion Dale Jarrett. Dale Earnhardt Jr. on the lead lap in eighth place, trying to work his way around DJ.
That's what he's got to do. If he's got any shot at all, he's got to get that lucky dog pass. Get the car handling better. And I think those guys have been really struggling with the handle of that car, haven't they, Dave?
They have been. The car has been loose, then it was tight, then it was loose again on that last stop. So they made a wedge and air adjustment. But during that whole run, DJ was very, very quiet on the radio. And I haven't known him that long, but it seems like when he's out there and the car is not good, he doesn't complain a lot, just tries to drive it, and it's just not good tonight.
Hey, he's driving hard because we said those brake rotors are just as red as they can be.
Here's a race for second place. Kurt Busch in the 97 trying to defend that spot from Ryan Newman's challenge.
Tell you what, Jeremy Mayfield got those four tires on and he's kind of driven away from these guys. From Kurt Busch, I think the 12 car of Ryan Newman may be a little bit better right now.
Right now, but I'd be interested to see what happens after they get some laps on the tires, because I think that's where Kurt Busch's car is really good after they've got about 30 or 40 laps on those tires.
Well, I'm going to tell you what, it must be slick out there if you get just an inch outside that upper lane. We've seen a car each of about the last five laps slide when he gets up high. This time it was David Green.
Jimmy Spencer was in turn two.
Terry Labonte and Elliott Sadler, separate laps down in turns three and four. And NASCAR's watching this also and has put the caution out. And they're going to send the sweepers out and try and blow off some of the tire debris and so forth outside the corners of the racetrack. So let's take a break. Jeremy Mayfield leads. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
About three steps back.
How to make the best of your 15 seconds of fame.
Ready?
This is Elliott Sadler's crew. Knowing we were filming them for winning the McDonald's drive-through pit crew championship fueled by Powerade at California last Sunday night, they spent the least amount of time on pit road among participating crews.
I agree with you, Todd. They're nuts.
And not only did they win the 20 grand for last week's pit crew win, they took over the lead in the season-long standings over Dale Earnhardt Jr.'s crew. Congratulations to the Elliott Sadler team. Got the jet blowers out to clean off the upper lanes of the corners, so an extended caution here in Richmond. We'll be back on TNT. TNT Sports back at Richmond. Pressure on the drivers. How about the pressure on the pit crews? Jeremy Mayfield's guys got it done.
Kenny Francis, crew chief, Jacksonville, Florida.
Bob Downs, front tire carrier, Homedale, New Jersey. Dana Worthing, front tire changer, Lincoln, Maine.
Rick Pennington, Jackman, Oakland, California.
Brent Wentz, rear tire carrier, Lehigh, Pennsylvania.
Mike Jansen, rear tire changer, Sibley Island.
Tank Probus, Gasman, Louisville, Kentucky.
Rich Muckenthaler, Ketchikan, Turner, Michigan.
Greg Miller, pit crew coach, Akron, Ohio.
They're from all over the place, aren't they? But they got the job done best on that last set of pit stops and got Jeremy Mayfield out in front of the field.
I love that Jackman, Rick Pennington. He's left-handed and looks like that really helps in their stops.
Now, inside of the lead lap cars, Dale Jarrett, first one lap down, hoping for a quick caution to get the free pass, the lucky dog, to come back around and rejoin a chase for a good finish and keep his championship chase dream alive. Dale Jarrett running in 26th place right now. First car one lap down. Only a few pitted under this last caution flag. Lead lap cars that stopped: David Green, Joe Nemechek, Jamie McMurray, Casey Kane, Terry Labonte. They are all from 19th place on down.
We may hear from them later.
Yes.
They have come in and put tires on, and possibly for the last time.
It sounds kind of silly saying that at 235 laps to go, but if this race runs green for a long time, and you might only have one pit stop left later, they might have to play some strategy if they're desperate. Dave?
Alan, I checked with the crew with those tires when they came off the car. There was a lot left in them. And remember, I talked about how they tested here to work on lessening the tire wear. Boy, have they hit it.
So Mayfield holding off Kurt Busch for now as they dice for the lead. You can see they've separated themselves from the traffic. Got another one dusting off the upper lane. That's Ward Burton in the zero.
We have seen that about five or six times tonight. They just get down into the corner and then all of a sudden they just shoot up the racetrack like they've hit ice.
Oh, a little traffic jam there. We talked about Casey Kane pitting under this caution flag. Matt, he's way back in 24th place.
Jeremy's in the green, Casey's in the yellow, restart at 24th, but he's
riding along. Now, Tommy Baldwin pitted him under that caution. Casey feels like he's losing too much ground on the racetrack. Once the pressures do build up, the car really comes in, but he loses so much track position, it's tough to make that up. Then they brought him back down pit road because under the low pressures, Casey says the car is bottoming out. They just want to make sure, BP, it wasn't the oil pan that was hitting.
Oh, yeah, because that's about the first thing that hits on these cars. They made everything to go up and get off the racetrack, but the oil pan, the engine has to stay there. And if the oil pan touches, it's going to knock a hole in it.
Uh-oh, trouble in two.
Got a big one, big stack.
Oh,
McMurray almost got
in. 21 is in there.
Casey Kane got through. The car against the outside wall to your left is Scott Wimmer, and the one to the right is Ricky Rudd.
Looks like.
And by the way, and while we were getting the pit report on Casey Kane, Carl Edwards passed Dale Jarrett.
Oh,
and so Carl Edwards is the lucky dog at this caution. Jarrett still trapped a lap down.
Well, first thing I do is get that 88 car working better, because that's their biggest problem.
All right, what made this mess?
Looks like the 27 is going to get in the back of the 77.
Something happened to the 77. It appeared, well, something had happened
going
in front already.
Yeah. They were checking up.
That's
just accordion.
Sorry, well, David Green, 27, Brendan Gaughan, 77, Greg Biffle with the National Guard car all caved in.
A lot of damage that 16 car. Yeah, the 22 car, we haven't seen him wreck yet.
Santa Fe, back at way down, clear, low. Gas, there you go, clear. You okay?
Yes would be the answer, as Nemechek's driven through it. Greg Biffle, though, is not. And we're under caution for the sixth time tonight here in Richmond. Green flag in the air as we come back to Richmond International Raceway on TNT. None of the leaders pitted, a couple cars toward the end of the field with accident damage. Did that story in a minute. Once again, Dale Jarrett finds himself the first car one lap down, trying to keep Casey Mears in that 41 behind him in case a quick caution comes out. And once again, it doesn't look like it's going to work.
Now, like I said, that 88 car has got to get handling better, or none of this is going to do him a whole lot of good. He drove the 41 up the racetrack there. He is doing everything he can to try to be in that position of lucky dog, but the car is just not handling.
Oh, there we go again. Oh, 88 gets in the 41, almost turns it, but not quite.
So, Dale Jarrett's struggle continues.
And Jimmy Spencer got by both of them in the four car
to become the first car one lap down.
Exactly, to become the lucky dog.
Well, actually, 4 and 41, Spencer and Casey Mears, they're racing for that spot there for me. And there may be a little sheet metal traded there, too. Rusty Wallace is the fourth place car in the two.
And the three wide.
Aye,
that's right.
And this isn't even for the lead.
No, yeah. This is just to stay one lap down behind the leader.
Yeah. NASCAR sending a warning from race control to the drivers.
Oh,
41 that they needed to settle down. And here we go. Dale Jr.'s in it. Jimmy Johnson.
And Mark Martin's in it. The sixth car.
Mark Martin has spun. I don't think he got hit.
And he continues on. I don't know how much damage he has.
Yeah, I just don't.
And welcome into the 400 point number with Jimmy Johnson. Because look at the damage on the nose of the 48.
Oh, my goodness gracious.
If Jeff Gordon has troubles later tonight, that could bring that 400-point number into play as far as drivers that get into the chase for the championship.
Oh, boys, I can't go anywhere.
It won't roll. Exactly right, Jimmy. So he may come out there sometime tonight, but he's going to be many, many laps down. Look at the damage.
Wow.
On that car.
There's going to be some hot drivers over that one, because that was pretty uncalled for. I mean, the four cars trying to race Casey Mears, that was just uncalled for.
Internally.
Says he's a tad ticked off.
Yeah.
Championship leader starting the race, Jimmy Johnson, with a mangled race car just past the start-finish line before we've even gotten to halfway tonight. You know, we talked about setting the 400 point aside for a minute. We talked about building momentum for the final 10 races.
All right, the word is to park in the four car, and I agree with that decision, because I'm sorry, but that I just think that could have been avoided, and it took a lot of good race cars out, and I'm glad NASCAR is making that call.
So Jimmy Spencer being sent to the garage area. You know, the officials talked about in the drivers' meeting earlier tonight, there's been a lot of discussion over how they would officiate this race with so much scrutiny on this chase for the championship and what was at stake and so forth. They talked that they would, well, first let's take a look at what happened.
And then we see Jimmy Spencer in the four car just come up and get in the 41 car and kind of turn him around. There's Jimmy Johnson. He runs into, who's he going to hit? The 25. And Jeff Gordon somehow gets through this.
And Mark Martin.
You got a lot of guys in that top 10 of points right there. Dale Jr. got turned around. Mark Martin really dodged a bullet on this deal. This could have cost him a shot at that top 10 right there.
It's Mark and Dale Jarrett that bounced off each other a little bit.
Dale Jr. has some pretty serious damage on that 8 car. And Brian Vickers 25 car, a lot of damage.
Good race cars tore up in that deal.
Coming at you. With Rusty Wallace.
Still there. Clear, clear. And behind you. Caution. Wow.
Wow is right.
Dale Jr.'s view, this won't be pretty.
Go low, go low, go low.
Steve Meehl, the spotter for Dale Earnhardt Jr., trying to tell him to go low, but it was already too late. Mark Martin.
Jimmy Johnson.
Our camera's gonna get killed, I'm afraid.
We've been talking about this camera all year.
Front of you, stay low, stay low.
There it goes.
Yep, camera's gone.
And the radiator and a lot of the front suspension on the 48 car for Jimmy Johnson.
And his patience. Oh, that's too bad.
Pit road has been closed. And NASCAR talked about, Mike Helton, the president of NASCAR, got up and addressed the driver's meeting earlier, and I spoke with NASCAR's vice president of competition, Robin Pemberton, about how they'll deal with officiating this race in the final 10. Basically, their answer is, like we have the first 25 races, but if anything is out of order, we'll act appropriately. Bill?
Mark Martin, in a very calm voice, says, I believe the car's okay. His spotter looked at it, and so did crew chief Pat Tryson. They all said it looks all right. So this is going to be a four-tire change, no adjustments, except they're going to sticker tires. They've been running scuffs throughout the race, so it's sticker tires for Mark. In front of him, Jeff Gordon is also on pit road. Gordon, a four-tire change, not believed to have any damage to that car either. They look at the grill, they give him his tires, he's on his way. His car just is not handled very well.
Looks like they might have made a change on the left rear of that 24 car, Bill, some kind of chassis adjustment. Dave?
Well, the 88 car of Dale Jarrett obviously needing work, as we have noticed. Dale said the same thing. We need to come in and work on this thing. We can't get a lap back like this, so they're going to pit this time. They're going to, they're suggesting maybe they make a wedge and a left spring adjustment on the car. DJ may be looking for some track bar to that wrench going in now, so that's a track bar adjustment. Just going to try to work around this car, find a chassis setup that'll make him fast enough at least to get back on the lead lap.
And they got some pretty good damage to the front fenders. They've got to fix on both sides of the car as well. You see a lot of attention to the lower corner of that right front. Dale Jr.
Looked like he got banged up pretty good in the left rear. I don't see much damage on the right side, but
that just came out of Junior's car.
That a crush panel?
Looks like it.
If it is, that's going to be trouble.
Yeah, crush panel. That means he'll get a lot of exhaust inside that car.
Crush panel, the aluminum that they use to make the fender wells and seal up the inside of the car, Matt.
And that's where they're working on the right rear back there, trying to repair that.
Well, Alan, this is the second stop down pit road for Dale Earnhardt Jr. They took a look at the damage and made some small minor repairs on the first stop. They brought him back in this time. They did have some huge pieces of tape just in case it needed to make some big band-aids on that car. They gave him the easy okay.
Marty Snyder is with Jimmy Johnson.
And he's come from the infield care center fine. What started all that, Jimmy?
Just a bunch of idiots. I mean, I don't know what the 41 did to make the 88 and the the four's so mad, I'd find it hard to believe he got both of them upset at him. But for about three laps, the 88 tried to wreck him, and he couldn't get it done. And then the four went up there and tried and finally got it done. I mean, he was chasing him from the bottom of the racetrack all the way up to the marbles trying to wreck him. I don't understand why or what, but, you know, this is the way this point system works. We've got desperate guys doing desperate things. And, you know, this can happen at Homestead. And that's the one thing I don't like about the point system is that you can have somebody acting like this and take it completely out of a championship. And we put too much hard work and effort into this to have something stupid like this happen. So we'll just roll on. Hope Lady Luck's on our side from here on out.
It was in no way targeted at you, was it?
I have no clue. I mean, I was so confused as to why they were trying to wreck for so many laps. And then they finally did. I'm really curious to watch the tape and see what happened.
Jimmy coming in, the championship leader, will lose a lot of points tonight.
A lot of folks involved in that crash. Spencer, Martin, Jr., Mike Wallace, Ricky Rudd, Brian Vickers, Sterling, Marlon Casey Mears, Jimmy Johnson, and DJ. No, I think I answered the question. That wreck was not directed toward Jimmy Johnson.
No, it was definitely, yeah. It wasn't directed at Jimmy Johnson. It was directed at somebody else, and he's driving a 41 car.
So Jimmy Spencer and Casey Mears tangle, the result, a 10-car pileup that claims two of the top three in the championship standings and sends the third down through the grass. Sparkling the nighttime sky, the Richmond International Raceway with a full house of 107,097 fans watching this race under caution after a multi-car pileup triggered between Jimmy Spencer and Casey Mears. Mike Helton, the president of NASCAR, stepped into the booth. Mike, we were talking about the fact that Jimmy Spencer's still on the racetrack. We're going to show a couple replays you folks have looked at to decide to let Jimmy continue racing.
Yeah, earlier before this caution, we had warned both the 4 and the 41 about the activity that was going on the racetrack. Then when the caution occurred, the initial reaction was is that the 4 might have caused this accident, and so there was question of whether or not what we would do with the 4. While we were reviewing everything, we had the 4 just stay out there. And in the meantime, after looking at the replays, if you could watch the 41 and the 4, particularly from the two cars in-car camera or one of the early replays where the 4 and the 41 are coming through turn 4 together, and if you watch the white hash marks, you see that the 41 drifts down. Closely, if you see the white hash marks, the 41 comes down. He's racing to get in behind the 2 there. And he comes down and cuts off into the 4, and it causes the accident. We've determined this is a racing accident, and we're not going to do anything with the 4.
All right, Mike. Appreciate the clarification. Right, thanks.
Thank you, Mike, very much.
Mike Helton, president of NASCAR. So Jimmy Spencer is out on track. That is Jimmy in the red 4 car.
You may want to stay here.
He's shaking his head. No, I'll go back to my perch. And we're back underway. Jeremy Mayfield the leader, Kurt Busch second, Ryan Newman third, Rusty Wallace fourth, Matt Kenseth fifth. And one of the two drivers involved in the beginning of the accident is Nick Marshall.
And that would be Casey Mears, Allen, and that had been going on for a long time with a 4 car. Do you feel it was intentional on Jimmy Spencer's part to wreck you?
Well, I mean, it definitely wasn't unintentional. I mean, he was running hard. Whether he meant to spin me out, I don't know, but he definitely meant to hit me. Championship lead. He wanted that lucky dog, but we were faster, you know, and we cleared him, and then the 4 car just flat took me out. I don't know what he was thinking. I mean, it hurt a lot of good cars behind us, and just another unfortunate day for the target team. I mean, we really had a good car there at the end. I felt like we made some adjustments. If we got back on that lead lap, we'd have a good car, and I just have no idea what Jimmy was thinking. He hurt a lot of cars.
Another crash on the racetrack, Alan.
It would be Ward Burton up against the wall in turn 3. Yellow flag is out.
And oh, poor Ward. He's been trying to do that all night over there in 3 and 4. He has been up along that wall at least 3 times tonight.
And the car will not roll forward, so he's trying to figure out what he can do to get to go forward, because he wants to go in the garage area to get this over.
I think he's trying to back up to the entrance there.
Yeah, there's an entrance they used during practice right there in the middle of 3 and 4, and Ward is going to duck into it. Pit road is closed. Ward knocked the commitment cone down into the middle of the pit lane entry, and somebody's going to run over that and damage the nose of a car if they try and stop.
I didn't think that thing was going to last all night, sitting out in the middle of the racetrack like that.
So things are getting interesting.
More than ever. There's that cone you're talking about, and yes, that could do some damage to those front ends on these race cars.
Everybody's missed it so far.
All right, now,
Remember I talked about when Jimmy Johnson being damaged, maybe bringing the 400-point mark back into play. The top 10 drivers plus any additional within 400 points of the championship leader at the end of tonight's race will qualify to race for the championship. There are your top 10 as of right now. But look how interesting it gets behind.
Casey Kane and Mark Martin are tied. Labonte is within the 400 points, and Kevin Harvick only 10 points out. McMurray only 22 out.
And that is to Jeff Gordon, now the championship leader, who runs 14th in this race. As Gordon moves forward, that could kick those guys back out. If Gordon has trouble, it could kick even more guys in to this chase for the Nextel Cup. Ooh, and we're not even to halfway yet. What lies ahead here at Richmond? Don't go away. It's going to be wild. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
Lights are on and the fans on their feet at the Richmond International Raceway. 107,000 of them watching the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. And there's been a little rocking and rolling out there lately with Robbie Loomis, crew chief for Jeff Gordon. You knew there was a bullseye on your car. There's a big one now. How is his ride?
The DuPont's Chevrolet's been handling great. We'd like to win this thing for Chevrolet tonight. It's just one of those things up and down. The car started out extremely well there early. We lost the handle on it, got a little tight. It's got to come back to us just now. We need to get some track position back. This DuPont team's doing a great job.
Did you get any damage out there in that incident?
No, we got a little damage right on the front end, but nothing we think it'll bother the car at all.
Robbie, good luck.
Thanks.
So Jeff Gordon now has to try and make his way through traffic, and obviously a lot of people thinking about 400 points.
Jeff Gordon running in 14th. In the race at the moment, the new championship leader with Jimmy Johnson back in the garage area. Mark Martin running right behind Jeff Gordon on the racetrack, and he's thinking about whether or not there would be some targeting on the speedway.
See if you could talk to the 10 about being a little bit more careful and not as wild. Tell him he's scaring me to death. I'm trying to make this race for the chase, and he's just so wild he's scared me.
24 wants to let you know he was sorry about getting into you there.
It's okay, man.
And before they went back to green in the previous caution, Mark, who had pitted and was back in the field, got on the radio and said, please help me with as many guys in front of me as you can. Make sure they are aware of our situation.
Like you talked about earlier, Wally, guys, guts twisted tight inside the
Absolutely.
Race car.
Absolutely, and Mark's one of those guys. If you know Mark Martin, his gut is tighter than anybody out there. He wants it bad. And you're trying to be as careful as you can, but it's hard to control the things that are going around, you know, beside you, other guys and race cars having their own agenda.
Mark running in the race right now in 15th place, in the chase in 10th. Jeremy Mayfield, the leader, back under green. Car to the inside, the 09 of Mike Wallace is now the first car one lap down. Lead lap, 25 drivers. Last of them, Bobby Hamilton Jr. And let's mention that to the garage after these recent wrecks, Ward Burton, Jimmy Johnson, Brian Vickers, Casey Mears, and Scott Wimmer, all behind the wall, getting repairs to their cars.
Tell you what, this 19 car, Jeremy Mayfield, he's doing everything he possibly can to be in the top 10 in NASCAR Nextel Cup points because he's fast and he's standing in the front and he's staying out there.
And he's in the safest place you could be on that racetrack right now. It's not around anybody. Guys like Mark Martin and Jeff Gordon and all those guys are 14th and 15th, but they're two abreast all the way back. So they're like 35th really on the racetrack. So Mayfield is definitely in the place to be.
A couple of guys I'm so impressed with. Kevin Harvick in the 29, Bobby Labonte in the 18, right in that crowd we're racing with, doing what they need to do tonight to try and get into this chase. Our Singular Wireless Race Talk poll, which driver will win his first short track victory before the others?
That was my pick, but not tonight.
Jimmy Johnson, 35%, Casey Kane, 33. Looks like those are the two leaders.
Obviously, the votes tabulated just before the wreck happened, huh?
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you for your participation. Riding on board with Robbie Gordon there for a second. Singular car having a tough night.
Oh, we got trouble in two.
That will be Casey Kane. Just in front of Dale Earnhardt Jr. when he spun.
Will it run? Will it run? Can he get it going?
Come on, come on, come on, come on, come on, come on.
He's going to get lapped.
He's trying.
He's going to have to back up.
He's trying.
He's going to get lapped.
Oh, man. Oh, and right now we have 25 cars in the lead lap.
Boy, oh boy. Now he's got it running, but he's going to be a lap down.
And he just ran over that piece of metal with the left rear that came off his car. Hopefully he didn't cut a tire, although he's probably flat spotted him anyway.
Casey Kane will come into the frame from the right side of your screen.
Like he gets a little bump from behind, maybe by Junior.
Well, let's see what the 8 says about it. Yep.
Yep, just a little bit of a bump from Junior, and around goes Casey.
One of those rule of five things where the 5th car back from where the bottle up happened, huh? Dave?
Just checked with Todd Barrier, crew chief for the 29. He said we're pretty good, a little bit loose in. They decided to pit now, put just a little bit of a spring rubber into the right rear. Marty?
Jamie McMurray, 11th in points, struggling with a very loose race car. His teammate Casey Mears is going to give him their best sets of tires for later in the race. All scuff sets of tires that Casey has already graded, trying to make the 42 car a little bit better.
So, caution flag is out here at Richmond International Raceway, the 9th one of the night. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. How are the Coca-Cola Racing family of drivers performing tonight here at Richmond International Raceway?
Not too badly.
Pretty good. 5 in the top 10.
There's more.
Some others who have taken a tumble here lately, Kevin Harvick thinking of particularly. He was running up in that lead group and then just made a pit stop under his caution. So pretty good night for the folks who drink Coke. Get ready to go back racing here at Richmond.
And this is, you know, these deals, this is what guys like Martin and these guys, they don't want to see this. They don't like these restarts right now because they're so far back in the pack. They just want this thing to go green so they can get sorted out.
Cautions breed cautions. You have one, they get all bunched up, and you're more liable to have one again.
3 lead lap cars that pitted under this caution. Kevin Harvick, Dale Earnhardt Jr., Jamie McMurray. They're 21st, 22nd, and 23rd.
Green, green, green.
Mike Wallace was the lucky dog at the yellow. He's back on the lead lap in 25th. And the first car one lap down now is David Green in the 27 car, that neon green machine. The back racing. I wonder how long this one will last.
Now here's where I think Bush's car gets a little bit better. BP, I don't know, we'll see what happens. But remember I said it looks like it takes 40 or 50 laps. We'll see if Bush, if his car does get better after we get some time on the tires.
Jeremy Mayfield led the most laps in tonight's race so far, 83. Remember, there's 5 more bonus points toward the championship if you lead the most laps in a race.
And we showed you Casey Kane was only 382 points out the last time we put this graphic up, but folks, that was before the spin out. You see, Mark Martin is still 382 back. Casey Kane is now over 400 because of that spin. He is out unless he can do something.
And Bobby Labonte trying to hang in inside that 400 point mark. This is going to come down to the last laps tonight.
Yeah, Casey Kane's going to have to do a lot, BP, because he's a lap down in 30th spot right now, and he's not even in a position to get the lucky dog if yellow were to come out right now.
There is Casey in the 9 car on pit road for repairs under this yellow flag. Dale Earnhardt, go ahead, BP.
The only thing that Casey Kane has going for him, he has time. He has a couple of hundred laps.
And by the way, the Bobby Labonte car, his name not being shown in green as being qualified for the championship, we set the parameters up as being to show you the top 10. And the 400-point numbers come into play, but we'll keep an eye on Bobby for you throughout the night and let you know how it is working.
Jeff Gordon, the 24 car, trying to work his way back to the front. Matt, how about the 9 car? How's he handling now?
BP, a big job ahead, starting now in the 30th position, going to work his way back up. Now, Tommy Baldwin finally migrated this entire air pressure setup on this 9 car back to how the car started. Casey felt like giving up way too much track position. Now, being a lap down, he's going to have to pass a lot of cars there. Not giving up. Tommy's on the box, coaching him. His cousin Cole, the spotter, coaching him. He's just now knocking off one car at a time.
He's got to pass 5 cars to be the first car lapped down, get the lucky dog, get a caution, and then start trying to pass guys on the lead lap.
And David Green, who's the first car lap down, is about almost a straightaway ahead of him on the racetrack.
So it is a long night's work for Casey Kane if he's going to make the chase for the next L Cup.
What he needs is a long green flag run, about 60, 70 laps, and stay right behind that 24 car.
Because you're thinking the 24 is going to go forward and pass a lot of cars.
I think the 24 is going forward, and I think the 9 car can follow him, get by all those other cars that are a lap down, and then hope for the caution flag.
6 different drivers have led tonight as we check our Little Debbie lap leaders. Jeremy Mayfield has led the most laps tonight. Mike Wallace, Jimmy Johnson, other leaders, Kurt Busch, Jeff Gordon, and Ryan Newman.
See the 24 underneath Elliott Sadler. Elliott Sadler looks like he's a lap or two ago. He was hung up behind Robbie Gordon, but Robbie looks like he's kind of pulling away there a little bit now. Got something on the 24, Bill?
Yeah, well, he's something to think about. Jeff Gordon really doesn't like these tires here at Richmond. They talked to his crew chief, Robbie Loomis, this afternoon. They believe the tires might actually be too hard for this track. He can't seem to get any grip. They've worked on the balance. But the tires here, really a curveball for that 24 team. He's going to have to overcome that if he wants to get to the front. He's been, I guess you could say, maybe complaining about him so far tonight. Marty, what do you got?
Weber in front of him is Elliott Sadler in the 38 car, last week's winner, and it's just been a struggle tonight for those guys. They need what we have now, a little green flag racing, because the car better the longer he runs. He's in the 10th position right now, but his car has been extremely loose at the start of a run. He said it's so hard to pass right now with a loose race car. I just can't get it done, guys.
Elliott coming off the win at California Speedway last Sunday night, which pretty much clinched his spot in the chase for the Nextel Cup. All he had to do was start tonight's race. He visited with Bill on the wagon on Discover Card Countdown to Green, said they had an extra battery on the car just to make sure. Now he's fashioning after a tux for his trip across the stage at the Waldorf Astoria in December. Jeff Gordon falling back off of Elliott Sadler in that race for a spot. Now Michael Waltrip closing in on him, and then behind them, Casey Kane in the 9 trying to look out.
Yep, we've been watching that for the last couple laps, and like I said, position Mark doesn't want to be in. He doesn't want a guy a lap down on the inside and a rookie in his bumper.
McShane Mill, the 23 car, in his, what, second NASCAR Nextel Cup race ever on his bumper.
And he's 4 laps down in 34th place is the 23 car. Cool. This call for Mark.
Bill, everybody wants to talk to you. What are they saying about, what's Mark saying?
Hey, what he's saying, Wally, is that he's asked for help from Bill Davis, his close friend, to give him some help with that 23 car. That's a very young driver in that car, and Mark really wanted him to know that he wanted by, and that's the situation. You got an experienced guy trying to get in the chase, and a young guy still learning. So we'll see what happens. But he did ask for some help from Bill Davis.
Yeah, I think he got it, and I think Shane, you know, smart enough kid to know that, hey, I'm 4 laps down, and this guy's in the chase. I'm not going to give him too much of a hard time right now.
Bobby Labonte just taken 6th place away from Jeff Burton, marching toward the front after starting that 18 car in 18th place. Marty?
He's done a great job, Alan, as we've told you a couple of times. Scuff tires really working for Bobby Labonte. They're trying to find some up and down pit road that will match their cars just like they like, just like this set of tires. He's a little bit loose. He said it's uncomfortable at the start of a run, but once it gets going, the car goes really well. Same thing with the car in May. Same exact car, same situation. It wouldn't go at the beginning of a run, but at the end of a run, they were great.
In the May race here at Richmond, Bobby started 27th, finished 3rd. A similar performance tonight just might be enough to do the trick and get him into the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. Jeremy Mayfield is out in front. He has led 101 of the 228 laps that we've run so far in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400 at Richmond. Mayfield trying to lock up a place in the race for the NASCAR Nextel Cup, perhaps with a victory tonight.
The Chevy Rock and Roll 400 on TNT is brought to you by Quaker State, the power to reduce friction. By Wrangler, makers of Wrangler Jean Company, a new generation of Wrangler. And by the United States Army, an army of one.
235, now 236 laps on the board at Richmond, a battle up front.
And the 19 of Jeremy Mayfield has actually swapped the lead with the 97 of Kurt Busch. Mayfield, a little loose coming out there, looking for the inside of the 42 and trying to continue his march. So it's a strong run for Jeremy Mayfield. Let's take you through the field, and Dave Burns goes first.
Bill, it's been a long time since Jeremy Mayfield has led a lot of laps. Last time he led more than 100 laps was year 2000 at Rockingham in the fall. Good night so far for Mayfield, still is.
Dave, Kurt Busch has 5 short track wins, more than anyone in the last 5 years, showing us why he's so good on these smaller racetracks. The car just won't turn right now, but pretty good. Matt?
Marty, Ryan Newman has the same problem. His car just will not turn in the center of the corner, especially down in turns 1 and 2. The biggest movement really is behind pit wall. Every time we throw the points up as they are right now, the 12 team and a lot of other teams run up to the monitor to see where they stand and where the competition stands. Marty.
Matty on the last stop for Matt Kenseth. No changes to the chassis. A little bit tight off the corners. He said the car feels like it's getting even better. Bill.
Rusty Wallace in the two cars. Last win here came in the spring of 97. A 6-time winner at this track. Driving a car they named the Predator. But right now it's not eating up the track as well as they were hoping. The two is too tight, Marty.
Bobby Labonte roaring to the front. Bill in the sixth position now. He finished third with his car here in May, second with it in Martinsville. Just a little bit too loose for Bobby Labonte. Elliott Sadler's car also starting to come to life with this long green flag run that he wanted. A little bit tight from the middle off. He's had 4 top 10s in his last 6 races, has the 38 car. Jeff Burton also having a very nice run in the blue car right there. He's currently in the seventh position. Not bad. More overall grip is what he would like. Using the brakes to set the nose a little bit loose in, Bill.
Well, Tony Stewart in that 20 Home Depot Chevrolet has gotten it into the top 10. Now apparently having a much more enjoyable ride than he had earlier. The car continues to be tight. It is tight in the middle of the turns. And you can't say enough about the 43 of Jeff Green. He's had some good runs at this track in the past, but hanging on to the top 10. So far, currently running ninth, 243 laps in. Good run for him. It's got somebody on his inside. That'd be Elliott Sadler, Matt.
And the 15 of Michael Waltrip, he has been working on the top 10 all night long. Earlier in this run, he said the car was good. Balance was where he needed it. But now, Bill, he said it's pushing off the corner late.
Mark Martin has not talked much about his car since they went back to green. Very focused on racing. He told me this afternoon he was dreading this race because if you make it into the top 10, that's what you're supposed to do. And if he doesn't make it, he said he'd probably feel like he wanted to break himself in half. That's a little severe, Matt.
Dale Earnhardt Jr., who won here in May, has fought his way all the way up to 13th. The car is tight everywhere, Dave.
Mike Bliss making only his second start in the Nextel Cup Series this season. Doing pretty well out there. Last pit on lap 207. No changes to the chassis. Car very neutral all night long. Bill?
Boy, Jeff Gordon just not having the ride he was hoping for. On the radio a few laps ago, something is wrong with this car. I just don't know what it is. A lot of people watching that car and watching the points, Marty.
Carl Edwards once again showing how good he is behind the wheel of a race car. 2 top 10s and just 3 Nextel Cup starts. In 16th, that's a flat right rear tire. Car's a little bit tight now, Dave.
He's a lucky dog, Mike Wallace. He was this last time. Remember, he lost positions when he had to pit under green a while back. They changed 4 tires and made no changes to the chassis, so working pretty good for him, Matt.
The 16 team basically called an audible. They've gone from the scuff tires, being a set of tires where you knock the new off, to sticker tires. His car still way too loose, even after the air pressure adjustment, Bill.
Joe Nemechek in the 0-1 car, past winner at this track, was running well earlier but fell out of the top 10 when they had a bad pit stop. He's battling with the 29, Dave.
29 of Harvick trying to get himself in the chase. Car getting a little bit better now. Remember, they pitted on that last caution to, they knew they'd lose track position, but they pitted early to do that. Marty?
Race man, the championship had hoped for tonight. He told me before he got in the race car, I think we have a top 5 car right now. He is in 25th for Jamie McMurray. His last quote to the team, I'm about to spin out. He has just gone down a lap for the second time tonight. Dave?
Marty? regarding the 88 of Dale Jarrett. They had a series of changes they wanted to make during the last caution. They wanted to do it to two stops. So they stopped once, put on two right side tires. They didn't have time to make the second stop to put on the left side tires and make changes there. He's lost two positions since. Matt?
Dave, Casey Kane has been quiet on the radio. He's only made up one spot now up to 29th. This is the guy that Jimmy Johnson said he's one of the guys that I fear most if he makes it in that final 10, because this team and Evernham Motorsports run well at most of those racetracks in the final 10. So Jimmy Johnson, who's locked in coming into Richmond, he was already sizing up the competition. And this little kid in the 9, if he gets it in, Johnson, he may be one of the guys to watch.
And right now, this 24 car, Wally, he is dropping like a rock. Bill Weber said there, he said there's something wrong with the car. He don't know what, but it's getting, seems to be getting worse and worse.
Yeah, he's lost three or four spots here in the last four or five laps. He's ready to get passed by Greg Biffle, and then Harvick is coming real fast. Are they saying it's an engine problem, Bill, or is it a chassis problem?
He just got his hands full, and he said exactly what we were talking about. There's something wrong with this car. I don't know what it is. So he's been very quiet on the radio. He is getting some lap times and updates on the cars coming behind him, but that is not the 24 car we're used to seeing at Richmond.
Or the car we saw earlier in this race.
So Jeff Gordon back to 17th. Meanwhile, up front, Matt Kenseth has passed Ryan Newman. He's passed Kurt Busch. He's up to second, and he's right on the back bumper of leader Jeremy Mayfield. We may have a new leader here in a minute. There are the standings in the race to the chase. It's Mayfield leading the most laps so far tonight, looking to solidify a spot for a championship bid.
And look at that. Mark Martin has now only 364 points out of the lead. Bobby Labonte, 377. Casey Kane, he just got to pick up two spots. Two spots, and he'll be at 400 points.
Jeff Gordon might pick that up for him if he continues to slide backwards. There are the top two. Kenseth in the 17, after Mayfield in the 9. Matt Kenseth is at Richmond International Raceway. Matt Kenseth has just passed Jeremy Mayfield off turn two because Mayfield is slowing down for a green flag pit stop. Lap 143 was the last time Mayfield and these other guys stopped. They stayed out on track under that series of cautions, Dave. Now they got to stop under the green.
And Jeremy has stayed out at least four times, Alan, under caution for going the pit stop for track position and to stay in the lead. No changes to the chassis here. A four-tire change and fuel in the car. Again, these guys stayed out last time, as you mentioned, hitting down after 120. A little slow to get away for Mayfield.
They had to wait for the fuel, for the car to get full of fuel, because that was a great tire change for those guys.
Now remember, the Dodges had traditionally gotten a little bit less fuel mileage than the Fords, or particularly the Chevrolets, in their racing configuration on a track like this. So it'll be interesting to see how much longer Matt Kenseth can stay out, along with Kurt Busch, Ryan Newman, and the others.
10 or 15 laps is going to be about all. We see there the 17 car. Kenseth, now the leader, puts Biffle a lap down and trying to put Casey Kane another lap down.
It's close.
But they have put Jeff Gordon in the 24 car a lap down.
Matt Kenseth hasn't won since the third race of the season back at Las Vegas in March.
But if Casey Kane, if this thing will go green long enough for the 17 car, the 97 car to make their pit stop, then he will gain a lot of ground on these fellas, because the 9 car made a pit stop about 60, 70 laps ago. He will not have to pit.
This car just doesn't look like it's driving that well, though, for Casey Kane. It looks like he's got his hands full there. The first micro power shaving system from Gillette is the new M3 Power, the new power behind the Gillette Young Guns. How many will make the chase is my question. That's where they run tonight. 5 of them were in beginning the night. As Kenseth peels off the pit road.
Well, he got all of it getting to that line.
Lap 269, now 270. As Kenseth crosses the start-finish line on pit road. Marty?
I think it was actually a little bit better at the end of that run than Matt expected. A little bit tight coming off of the corners. Pick up a half turn of Reds in the right rear, trying to loosen up the 17 car of Matt Kenseth. The car was stalled when he came to pit road, and also the rubber underneath the left rear is on fire for the 17.
Stop,
and I think the 17 bunch won it.
And what around. That's one reason he got so much skin in on Pear Road. He was out of fuel.
He's got the jack. Did they leave the wrench in the car?
Oh, man, what a mistake.
That just cost him.
He'll have to come back for that.
Man, oh, man. See, that's what we talked about. These crew guys are...
Get the wrench out of there. Let's go here.
A lot of pressure right now, these crew guys. That's a mistake that may have cost him the win.
Had a very, very fast race car, and I don't know that they can overcome this.
So Kenseth back down pit road at 40 miles an hour to the attention of his crew. Get the wrench, and off he goes. But he's going to lose a lot of time. Kurt Busch on pit road. Bobby Labonte on pit road. Ryan Newman's the leader. Marty?
Car starting to get too tight for Kurt Busch. They make the track bar adjustment that you see. Actually, the wedge adjustment that you see on the right side of the 97 car, especially at the end of that run. That's why he lost all the track position. Three stalls in front of him. Bobby Labonte, the car very good. They're going halfway back to where they were before. Car a little bit tight at the end of that run. Half pound on the right front tire for Bobby Labonte, who's having an excellent run.
So Labonte heads back on track. Michael Waltrip next among the lead cars to come to pit road. And we keep an eye on both Ryan Newman and Rusty Wallace. They will follow Michael Waltrip down the pit lane. So Newman, who took over the lead when Kurt Busch stopped, makes his visit to the pit lane at lap 274. And Jeff Burton goes to the point.
Man, 127 laps to go. Can these guys make it the rest of the way on fuel?
Yes.
I don't know.
Ooh, that Bill. Was close, Bill.
And Rusty Wallace got clipped by the 27 cars. He was pulling into his pit. He's got some left rear damage. Looks like it's only cosmetic, but it might have knocked out the bumper. This is four tires for Rusty's car's a little tight.
Matt Moreland pushing as long as he could. A track bar already completed on Ryan Newman's Dodge. We told you that late in the run, the car was just way too tight. He could not get it to turn in the center of the corner, and he's down and away.
Elliott Sadler also on and off pit road on this lap. Jeff Burton's the leader. Tony Stewart is second. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is third. Mark Martin is fourth. And then Mike Bliss will move up to fifth. Earnhardt Jr. on a different pit stop sequence than these other guys who are stopping now. And we expect Jeff Burton in shortly.
We're running on board with Jeff Burton. There he goes.
We'll have to wait until the cycle of stops completes to figure out exactly how badly that mistake hurt Matt Kenseth, but for right now, he's being shown back in 30th place.
Two laps down. Here comes Stewart.
We keep our constant vigilant eye on the championship standings and who's in and who's out in the race to the chase. As Tony Stewart makes his visit to the pit road.
And you'll see that Casey Kane is going to be Bill Weber.
20 of Tony Stewart on pit road. He's had a good night. He's been able to work his way back into the top 10. They come around to the right side first, change those tires, and whip around to the left. No chassis adjustments, it doesn't appear, so it's a four-tire change in fuel for Tony Stewart with 279 laps on the board here at Richmond. What, 5 years ago tonight right here at this track.
Had some trouble getting away from his pit stall, it looked like.
And Chuck White has some trouble with the jack on the right side. Cost him a second or so.
So Tony across the pit speed exit line and begins to accelerate on the apron of the racetrack. So Jeff Burton waiting on his stop to pit road. Then it'll go to Dale Earnhardt Jr. who'll be the leader. Now these guys that are stopping now, it all pitted under the yellow at lap 143. Junior stopped as late as lap 207. Remember when he was involved in the incident? And then the second dust up with Casey Kane made several stops to pit road for repairs and so forth. So he's got about 60 laps more on fuel than some of these other guys who've been stopping.
Here's our leader making his entrance on the pit road, Jeff Burton.
And his stop is going to come at lap 282.
So he can make it the rest of the way easily. Marty, coming to you.
Yeah, just to confirm that, VP, they can make it the rest of the way for Jeff Burton. This is another solid run for the 30 team since Burton's been in the car. His fourth race in the 30 car. It's loose at the start of the run, fairly good at the end of the run, so they will make no changes to the chassis. A little slow on the front tire, on the right front tire for Jeff Burton's team. Critical pit stop, a team that can win the race, but they could lose it here on pit road.
Pretty good stop, though. That puts Earnhardt Jr. at the point.
Yep, moves Mark Martin to second, Mike Bliss to third, Carl Edwards to fourth, Mike Wallace to fifth.
Mark Martin.
Yep, Mark last stopped at lap 183, so he was about 40 laps out of sequence to these other guys. Okay. So Jr. had 60 laps, Mark had 40 laps.
Mike Bliss underneath Mark Martin, trying to take the spot.
And that's going to be for second place. And again, Mark being careful tonight, or as careful as you can be to be racing on a next Elk Cup short track. Pretty nice job by Bliss tonight. Marty told you earlier, I think it was Marty, his second next Elk Cup Series race this season, ran the Chicago race earlier this year, finished 31st, first for Joe Gibbs.
And he's trying his best not to slide up, not to get in the corner too hard, and slide up and hit the sixth car.
And you notice Mark's giving him a lot of room when they go into the corner. Mark's not driving right down on the left side.
So they race for second, while Dale Earnhardt Jr. holds the top spot. Got a sequence of out-of-kilter pit stop schedules that have shuffled Jr. to the head of the pack. Caution flag has just come out here at Richmond International Raceway, and this makes things really interesting.
Boy, does it ever.
Yellow flag for contact between Dale Jarren and Jimmy Spencer that sent Spencer's four car around.
Looks like Spencer was just trying to get down underneath the 22 car of Wimmer, and Dale Jarren was right there.
Well, let's see what Junior sees from the Budweiser car. Yeah, there we see.
In front of you.
Dale Jarren bounced off the wall.
Very good.
Now, Jimmy Spencer got going. The leader, Dale Earnhardt Jr., had passed him before he resumed speed, and so he is being black flagged for passing the pace car to catch back up to the end of the field.
Jimmy was dragging something underneath there.
Dragging something. I saw some sparks.
And so Jimmy is going to be held a lap to be put a back one lap down, and then be held a lap as a penalty for not stopping on the racetrack when instructed, etc. Pit stops under the caution flag. With 106 laps to go, Dale Jr. comes in. Mark Martin is in. Guys who had not yet pitted under the green flag, and a few who had. Dave?
Kevin Harvick gives up eighth place. The car was loose into the corner, loose off the corner. They'll make a track bar adjustment to this car. Four tires and fuel for Harvick.
Marty?
Dave, Jamie McMurray, very, very loose. They're going to make three air pressure adjustments, a pound out of both rear tires for more forward grip, and also a pound in the right front tire for McMurray. Bill?
Mark Martin on his way. Traffic with the 99. He clears him. It was four tires and a chassis adjustment to loosen him up. Mark's just a little too tight. Matt.
Bill, service already complete on Dale Earnhardt's beaten and battered Chevrolet. He says it's loose on entry, a little snug to the center, and I like it a lot. Don't change a thing.
Boy, this caution flag has really changed the look of the lead group in this race.
I guess so.
Boy, Jeremy Mayfield was out of the top 10. He was out of the chase for NASCAR Nextel Cup, but it looks to me like he's back in and out, right behind Junior.
Mayfield stopped under the green back at lap 264. I'm just looking back at guys who were already stopped under the green and where they've played out. Frankly, I'm going to need a minute to sort this out. So let's take a break here.
Good idea.
And let me regroup. I'll explain it all to you when we come back to Richmond on TNT. Welcome back to Richmond International Raceway. Sellout crowd watching the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. TNT's live coverage as the race nears its three-quarter mark. Okay, here's what's happened. Kurt Busch came off pit road first of the cars who stopped. He's ninth in line in that outside lane. Eight cars who had made green flag pit stops stayed on track under this yellow. They are tail end of the lead lap in front of Kurt Busch. Those drivers are Ryan Newman, Rusty Wallace, Bobby Labonte, Tony Stewart, Michael Waltrip, Jeff Burton, Elliott Sadler, and Matt Kenseth. They run from 18th to 25th positions. And they're hoping to stay in front of Kurt Busch, catch a quick caution, and come back around and rejoin the chase for the win.
Wow. Good job, Alan.
Good
enough. Even I understood that.
But they need a caution flag. Bobby Labonte is the guy that really gets hurt if they can't get that caution flag, because Labonte now is 15th in NASCAR next up on points. He was in, now he's out.
Let me correct one thing. Kurt Busch did not stop. That's how he took the lead. First guy off pit road was Mike Bliss. So.
whoa, easy, boys.
Now let's see what happens. Boy, if you could see my notepad. I have sloppy handwriting anyway, but it's a mess now. How come Kurt Busch didn't stop on this yellow, Marty?
Because they are gambling, Alan. They've had a terrific chassis all night long. They are 10 laps short from making it to the end, banking on some caution laps here tonight at Richmond.
Well, we'll see how that plays out.
So when's the last time he stopped? He must have stopped on the green flag just before this.
Get that number for you here in just a second.
Okay. So he stopped at 272. So yeah, 128 laps is...
That's doable.
Yeah. Have a caution flag, so that's going to help.
Because we heard some pretty big numbers about fuel mileage down in the garage area.
And by the way, now in front of leader Kurt Busch, also Brendan Gaughan, who got through in the traffic jam on the restart, so add him to the tail end of the lead lap cars in the 77. He's in 25th place. NASCAR.com's Pit Command with Track Pass. While you're watching your race, have your computer nearby. You can have some real-time telemetry on screen, program your favorite drivers in, follow them and their path around the racetrack. All kinds of different things available there for you. Check it out. Exclusive content and live racing action. AOL and NASCAR.com.
The 7 and the 31. Robbie Gordon and Kurt Busch are leaning on each other.
Robbie Gordon, the 31 car, is a couple laps down. But if he can stay there, he's only going to be one down.
I tell you, this little turn of events with the caution after the green flag pit stops for some but not everybody has put Jeff Gordon up in the running order and taken the 400 number back out of play for those guys outside the top 10. So this thing is changing lap by lap here at Richmond. What's up with Mark Martin, Bill?
Well, Alan, all season long we've talked about Mark's bad luck. Well, tonight a little bit of good luck. When his team took off the left rear tire under caution on this most recent stop, they found a small hole in it, and that tire was going flat.
And for the lead, Dale Earnhardt Jr. by Kurt Busch. Driver 8 is first.
Man, he gets around this racetrack. Talk about Junior in that 8 car.
Yes, he does.
Won the race here in May.
3 top fives in the last 4 Richmond races, BP. That car looks beaten and battered, Matt, but it's sure running fast.
Leading his 7th consecutive short track race. Now, when Junior was involved and hit by the 48 on the big one off turn 4, after several stops, he said, how bad does this race car look? Does it look beat up? And they said, yeah, it looks pretty beat up. So it looks really cool all beat up. They go, yeah, because you know what? It would look really cool winning this race with a big old beat up race car.
Okay, folks, it's time. Wally, cue the duck.
In stereo even.
Yes.
Our Aflac NASCAR Nextel Cup trivia question. Who was the last driver to sweep Richmond NASCAR Nextel Cup races and win a championship in the same year?
Oh, man.
A doubleheader question for you. See if you can get this one. It is not the car in the picture.
Not the car in the picture. Well, he's never won a championship. I knew that.
Very good. Who is it? Hurry up. Come on.
Matt Kenseth.
No.
Rusty Wallace. Okay.
1989. Junior trying to become the first driver to sweep Richmond since Rusty Wallace in 89. And as an added bonus, Rusty went on to win the championship that year, something Junior would very much like to do. In 2004, Junior locked in to the 10-race chase for the Nextel Cup that starts next Sunday, 1 week from tomorrow, at New Hampshire International Speedway here on TNT.
I was always better at tests when I had the answers. EVP.
Brendan Gaughan has slipped back behind leader Dale Jr., so he is no longer on the lead lap. Jamie McMurray, 42.
Jamie's up in 7th?
Yep.
Boy, that old deal helped him a lot.
Sure did.
It's, you know, it happens every time. That green set of green flag pit stops begin when there's guys who can run longer on fuel.
And not only is he seventh in running order, look, he is 10th.
Yes, sir. That...
For the chase of the NASCAR Nextel Cup. Oh, my goodness gracious.
What a turn of events.
Okay, who's 11th? Mayfield. Where's Mayfield running?
In the race?
Now.
Third.
He's third. Wow. Boy, so McMurray knows he's got to go.
He's got to go.
How about Bobby Labonte? 1 minute he's in, the next minute he's 15th. Unbelievable. 86 laps to go here at Richmond. What kind of drama will play out in the final laps to twist the title picture? Stay with us and find out. Might we see a Wrangler five-star finish here at Richmond tonight? We did a couple of years back, September 2001. In the Chevy Monte Carlo 400, Ricky Rudd and Kevin Harvick trading sheet metal a couple of times in the final laps. Ricky, the final exchange of lead with five laps to go to score his second win of the season. For more on Wrangler five-star finishes, go to NASCAR.com. They never let you forget, do they, BP?
No. Sean Warren once again falling off the wall.
Sean appreciates it.
Yep. Dale Earnhardt Jr. is your race leader with 77 laps to go. One of 25 cars on the lead lap, Jeff Burton being the last of them. Now let's go through the field. Matt, lead us off.
Dale Earnhardt Jr. trying to score his second Richmond win this year. Jeff Clark, the gas man, who also helps calculate the fuel mileage, they are good to go the distance on fuel, Marty.
Matty Kurt Busch is in second in the 97 car. He said the car feels sideways at the beginning of a run, but he gets better the longer he runs. A car excellent at the end of a run. They are, again, 10 laps short on fuel, Dave.
Jeremy Mayfield has enough fuel to the end, but he didn't take on any tires on that last pit stop. Not to worry, they didn't do that early in the race, and it worked very well for them. 80 car Mike Bliss, great run for those guys. That's his Busch Series crew pitting him. Got him off pit road so fast, Steve Eddington, the crew chief, said, I was so excited I forgot to stop the stopwatch. I knew it was good, I just didn't know how fast we did it. Weber?
Jeff Gordon has enough gas to get to the finish. The question is, will he have enough brakes to reach the finish? He's very concerned. The pedal's soft. He's having to work it very hard. So Gordon looking at brake issues here inside of the final 75 laps. Behind him, the six of Mark Martin. Mark told me this afternoon he doesn't want to know where he is in the race to the chase. He just wants to run as hard as he can, finish as high as he can, then see where he is. Marty.
Weber and Jamie McMurray's last three races, his worst finish is seventh. Right now, he's in seventh. They did it on 294. They were out of sequence with everybody else. That's how they were able to make up so much track position. Can make it all the way. The car has been loose. Carl Edwards, great recovery at the finish. Battle for the lead. Kurt Busch going for it, Alan.
And
going
to get it by Dale Earnhardt Jr. with now 72 laps to go. Kurt Busch out in front.
Tell you what, this 97 car tonight has just been simply awesome.
Especially on the long runs. Mm-hmm. And if this thing stays green, that's double for these other guys. Kurt's car's been excellent after they get some tires on these laps on these tires. You know what I mean.
We did. You just had your twirls twisted. So Kurt Busch trying to pick up what would be his third win of 2004. He locked up his place in the chase for the Nextel Cup earlier tonight in the opening laps when Todd Vorine fell out of the race. Continuing through the field, we left off with ninth place, Mike Wallace. Dave?
He's doing a great job keeping that car in contention, Alan. Pitted last time for four tires and air out of the right front tire. That will help a tight race car loosen up just a bit. Matt?
Rounding out the top 10 is Greg Biffle. Back on lap 297, there's the 97 car up against the wall down in turns one and two.
And he has slowed down the backstretch. But now it looks like he's got the car back going again. The 8 car has gone by him, as also the 19 car has gone by.
So Kurt Busch with a moment down in the corner the last time by. He just took the lead, and now he's falling back to third. What's that all about? Just jumped the cushion?
One little mistake. Looks like, let's take a look. Got loose.
Whoa.
Getting into the corner. He's going to have to dial some brake to the front of that car, looks like, BP.
And he never hit the wall. Junior goes down the corner and says, my goodness, what happened to the 97 car? I would imagine that Dale Earnhardt Jr. in his 8 car thought maybe he's going to hit some oil as well. He might have oil. That was not the situation.
That looked like he just had a lot of rear brake in that car.
And you know what else that just did? That just put Jeremy Mayfield back into the top 10.
That's right. That one move.
When he passed Kurt Busch for second place, it put Jeremy Mayfield back into 10th place in the race for the championship by 4 points over Jamie McMurray.
And it knocked McMurray out. Yeah, that deal.
That's
right,
the bad
there.
News.
Yeah.
Unbelievable.
Because we see the 400-point rule, as long as Jeff Gordon is running this well, does not apply.
Look at that. Man. Marty.
Kurt has not said a word on the radio, Alan, since the little slip up there going into turn one. But we did tell you in through the field, he said the car is sideways about 15 laps before that happened.
Well, it was sideways there, that's for sure. But he gathered it back up and holds on to third position. Kurt has fallen 1.2 seconds behind Dale Earnhardt Jr. Mayfield stalking Earnhardt Jr. as Dale Earnhardt Jr. tries to pick up what would be his third win here at Richmond International Raceway and his fifth win of 2004. And the top spot changes hands again here at Richmond International Raceway in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Jeremy Mayfield has gone to the point. Kurt Busch has gone to second. And Jr. has faded back to third.
Here we see Mayfield, the 19 car, gets alongside Dale Earnhardt Jr. Just kind of takes that spot away. We see the blue car, the 97, saw the blue nose. He's back after these guys after that slip up down in turn one.
They see Junior fading back off these top two, and now Kurt Busch trying to recover from that whoops.
Whoa.
Up the hill.
Kurt is catching him.
And trying, whoa, boy, he's giving it everything, isn't
yeah.
he? Hey, check your paper tomorrow for a special offer from Domino's. You can also receive 20% off from the NASCAR.com Superstore. Domino's, the official pizza of NASCAR. One of those going to taste good to talk this race over when it's done.
That's a good idea. And 20% off. Tell you what, this Kurt Busch, if he doesn't crash it, he's going to be in front.
He's got nothing to lose right now, although there is something for him to lose. Because remember the standings, Kurt is up to fifth. And when the point totals are adjusted at the end of this race, that'd be, what, 25 points better than being 10th if
yes.
for some reason
right.
ends the race car up and doesn't finish. So he's going to be in the chase, but he doesn't want to lose, you know, I mean, those, like we're seeing tonight, those 25 points from Homestead time
yeah,
could be
absolutely
huge.
Check who's 10th now. Mayfield has gone tonight. Ryan Newman has fallen back to 10th, and he's only, just a few points, 7 points in front of Casey Kane.
So there it is.
I mean, Jamie McMurray, I'm sorry.
The gap, the 400 number, and now the deficit from 10th place as they run on the racetrack. Only 10 points for Jamie McMurray. That can be as little as two or three finishing positions.
Here's the lead. Busch gets it.
Man.
So 52 to go, and Kurt Busch back out in front.
But you're right, Alan, this race of the chase is going to come down to the absolute last lap of the race. Marty, we got the 97 back in front.
A very impressive rally, very calmly. Kurt Busch said, we've got it back now, guys. And this is not even the best car they could have brought here to Richmond. The car that won New Hampshire, they're saving for next week. This car is a sister car. They decided on Monday to bring this one and save their best one for next week when the chase for the Cup starts.
Check out a race for 19th and 20th place between Ryan Newman and Bobby Labonte, two of the guys trying to get those top 10 championship positions. Matty?
Alan, back on lap 309, Ryan Newman said, I hit debris up by the wall again. I'm serious, I'm not kidding. I hit it the last lap. His bigger concern, though, he is 5 to 7 laps shy of making it the distance on fuel, Marty.
Matt, the chassis handling so well for Bobby Labonte. The problem is he's got too much track position he needs to make up if he wants to make it in the chase for the championship. I talked to one of the crew members. He said, we got caught on pit road with our pants down. That's what happened. They pitted too early. Then they were out of sequence with everyone else. The caution came out. That's how Bobby Labonte is back in the field. He has a top 10 car, but not the track position to back it up.
That's right, Marty. Boy, and that track position is everything in these races now. Gave up all that for just having the caution come out at the wrong time.
I mean, what, you know, talk about the night Bobby Labonte's had, the roller coaster, right? Started 18th place, worked their way up, great car into the top 10. They're in the championship. Pit under the green, caution comes out, boom, they're out. They're tailing the lead lap and they're struggling. Caution comes out now, He's still in front of the leader, comes back around, puts some fresh tires on.
It's a whole different ball game.
Who knows what could happen? Let's check our Napa Field summary.
Oh, easy
while
there.
We watch Jamie McMurray try to pass Mark Martin for sixth. Nine leaders tonight.
And 99 gets one.
And he just passed the 42 car, and that's another 3 points he gained on him. Actually, that's 4 points.
Cars out of the race include Scott Riggs, who has just retired with some damage to his car, Ward Burton, Kirk Shelmerdine, Derek Culp, and Todd Bodine. It's been everything it was built to be tonight so far here in Richmond, and we're not done yet. 46 laps to go. Kurt Busch leads the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. You're watching NASCAR on TNT.
The Chevy Rock and Roll 400 on TNT is brought to you by Budweiser. It's time for a fresh one. Grab a Budweiser. The race is on. By Chevy, the winningest name in racing, an American revolution. And by new M3 Power from Gillette, the new power behind the Gillette Young Guns.
Spectacular night here in Virginia's capital city. Tonight, the ninth biggest city in this Commonwealth, with some 107,097 filling all the seats here, watching Kurt Busch try to pick up the win in the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. He's trying to put a lap on Tony Stewart, the 22nd place car, and he's got a lot of those guys right in front of him that are hoping desperately for a caution that they could come back around and get back in the mix to this thing, like Stewart, like Ricky Rudd, like Elliott Sadler, Ryan Newman, Bobby Labonte. They're all just in front of leader Kurt Busch.
This is going to get interesting, because I'll tell you what, he's got a lot of good cars he's trying to put a lap down. Guys like Tony Stewart, and that 19 car is right back on the bumper.
Here are the guys in so far.
Boy, 90, you got Jeremy closed right up on Kurt Busch there in traffic, and he's going to have a lot of that to deal with right now.
You see at this moment the 400 point number not coming into play. Jimmy Johnson involved in a crash earlier tonight, brought it back into focus some. And there are the deficit that McMurray faces to Jeremy Mayfield to get the 10th spot. Eighth place, as few as two, maybe three finishing positions.
And right ahead of these guys, we got Elliott Sadler, Newman, Bobby Labonte. All could go a lap down.
Mayfield running second, McMurray running eighth at the moment, as we work into the final laps of this one. Kurt Busch led six times tonight for 66 laps. He last pitted at lap 271. Very slight advantage on Jeremy Mayfield, the 19 car, who runs second. Dave?
Jeremy Mayfield has led so many laps tonight, peaking at the right track at the right time, Alan. Houston not run well here. His average finish at 21 starts is 22nd. Last fall, he finished second here, learned a lot. This spring, he had his best qualifying run ever, and then bested that tonight, starting seventh. So it's the right time for these guys to be picking it up here at Richmond.
Now, the question is, can the 97 car, do they have enough fuel?
I think the 12 car is the guy that's really concerned, because, Matt, didn't you say it was a few laps short?
BP, they're saying somewhere between 5 and maybe 8 laps short of fuel.
So what that means for Ryan Newman?
Ryan Newman is out of the race for Chase if he has to stop for fuel, because right now he's in ninth position, but only about 15 points ahead of Jamie McMurray.
Ninth as far as the race, as far as the championship's concerned, 19th on the racetrack. If he comes down pit road, it could drop him back. Boy, as far as 27th, 28th.
How about the 97, Marty? Can they make it on fuel?
Wally, I just checked with Jimmy Finning, and the situation has not changed. Nine laps short.
Nine laps short.
Short. Is that what you said, Marty?
Yep, BP, they are nine laps short.
Oh,
not changed.
All right, Marty needs a pit stop there to
change your batteries.
Tune up his batteries. We'll get that done quickly and get him back on the job in the 97 pit. Kurt Busch just putting Elliott Sadler, 20th place car.
Can I do a deal, Junior, at down. Bristol in the spring?
I don't think so, Kurt. Not after you told us you're going to. You know what he was talking about?
Yeah, oh, yeah. Yeah.
At Bristol this spring, Dale Earnhardt Jr. in the 8 car admitted to spinning out to get a caution flag so he can make a pit stop. He went on to win the race. And Kurt Busch just asked Jimmy Finning, can I pull a junior at Bristol?
I don't think it's going to help them.
I don't think
situation.
I'd spin out here at Richmond. It's kind of fast. Working on Ryan Newman, who also needs a caution. Believe me, yellow comes out in this one. Either way, yellow or green to the finish. The final laps of this, we're going to change that championship picture big. Somebody's going to be in going into the last 10 laps of this thing and end up out.
Oh! 97 baby. Is sliding all over the place right now, especially off at turn two.
And that little wiggle brings Mayfield in for the back.
Yeah. And Newman is doing, there he goes.
Man, he drove her in that time. I guess Newman finally gave him some, cut him some slack.
I agree with you on that.
Jeremy Mayfield has no comfort margin here. He is the 10th place driver at this point, and he's only 8 points ahead of 11th place. He has no comfort margin. He has to keep pouring the coals on the fire.
He's doing it,
but he's only 6 points behind Newman.
I'd rather be in ninth, wouldn't you?
Yeah.
Than 10th.
6 points behind Newman, and how many points? He's what, 8 points behind?
I wonder if Mayfield's
8 points behind, ahead of McMurray.
I wonder if Mayfield's team has told him that, hey, Kurt Busch is not going to make it on fuel if this thing goes green all the way.
Are they going to make it on fuel? I guess about the 19 car.
Well, that's what I was just going to say. He last pitted at 264, Dave. What are they saying?
Guys, the 19 is good on fuel. They have not mentioned the 97 situation over the radio.
Okay.
And they stopped to win 264. Wow, no.
No way.
I think so.
Not good enough to get to the finish?
I don't think he can make the rest of the way. 136.
Yeah, Dave. Seven of those laps were under caution, though, BP. What do you think, Dave?
They finished lap 292, according to my notes.
Okay.
That final caution, guys.
All right. They can make it from there, no problem. Let's compare notes.
Yeah, there he is. He is at 293.
He can make it.
He can make it the rest of the way, no problem.
We defer to the pit reporter.
Yes. Attaboy, Dave.
So, Earnhardt Jr. running in third spot, 2.5 seconds behind the leader, Kurt Busch.
I guess they're just going to run until the fuel pressure gauge starts fluctuating and hit the pit road or the run out.
Yeah, why not?
Yeah. There's no point stopping now.
Yeah, I mean, either way, you stop now, you lose everything, and if you run out of gas on the, go for it.
Yourself all tuned up there, Marty?
I think, Alan. Okay. I think I can talk. I'm not going to move while I talk, but they're planning on bringing Kurt Busch down. 9 laps to go. Top him off with fuel.
17 cars. Slow is he on? Coming to Pitts Road, yes.
Matt Kenseth in with 20 laps to go. Kenseth coming in from 13th position. For a splash and dash, Marty.
Yeah, same thing as his teammate. This is splash and dash. You didn't call it, Alan. A little bit of fuel, about 5.5 seconds worth for Matt Kenseth. They push him off. The engine stalled. Now they're going to have to push him down pit road. This is the second time they've had a costly mistake on pit road today.
I think he was out of gas when he came down pit road, wasn't he, Marty? Because they were already putting fuel in.
Yeah, he did sound like he was not running. That's twice today it's come down pit road, not running. Look at the guys trying to push it down pit road.
Forget
as
it.
Now Brian Vickers comes by him.
What the hell?
You guys, when you do that, you can't get the car refired, you lose 2 laps trying to get that thing started.
So Kenseth left earlier with the adjustment wrench in the back windshield, had to come back in, dropped him way back in the field. Worked his way back up to 13th by not pitting under that lap 293 yellow. And now he's going to fall way down to 28th place at this point. So keep go ahead.
Unusual for those guys.
Yeah.
On the 17th bunch, because they're usually one of the best teams on pit road.
Car, Dave.
Alan, they have now radioed Jeremy saying, quote, there is some speculation as to whether whether the 97 can make it on fuel or not.
I figured that message was going to get delivered eventually.
You bet.
Have they been listening to us or what?
Yeah. I would want to know that if I was Jeremy, because then you don't have to push yourself so hard. You know, you're going to try to pass a guy, but if I'm sitting there saying, hey, the guy's 10 laps short on fuel, I'm just going to keep him in my windshield.
Still watching Ryan Newman, Matt.
Laps are winding down, 15 laps to go. Ryan Newman and the 12 team, emotions starting to run high. Concerned whether they're going to be in or out of the chase for the cup.
They're thinking about it.
Matt, are we in good shape? It's real close, Ryan.
I guess.
And I guess that's all Borland wanted to say, wasn't it, Matt?
And VP Matt Borland, 2 laps ago, just told Ryan Newman, our calculations show we are 1 lap short of making it. Conserve all the fuel you can, because we're not going to stop. We're going to go to the end.
Who's that for?
That would be the 12. They're rolling the dice.
When you're that close, you're not going to conserve fuel.
No.
I mean, you know, I understand that's what they may want to do, but you know what? When you're that close on making the top 10, you're going to stand on the gas, and if you run out, you run out.
And back to what you said at the very top of the broadcast, Wally, there's a driver in the car with his guts twisted around trying to figure out how this is going to turn out while he's out there racing.
Yes, sir.
But see, he's ninth right now. He's still got a few points. He's got 6 points to play with.
Not many.
That's it. 6 points isn't too much. That's one spot.
McMurray is the guy that's going to be so angry. 8 points.
Are we hearing about McMurray? Maybe not running on all 8 cylinders now? that's the 11th place driver.
No, he looks like to me he's running all of them.
Boy, it doesn't sound good.
No.
Sound good.
Somebody sure sounds like they're on 7. You're right.
Wow. So he is running in 8th place now and can't afford to give up any spots. And that's Mike Wallace right behind him in the 09, running 9th, trying to take a spot away and some of those oh-so-precious points.
Yeah, and he's catching them really, really fast. Marty, got problems?
He is on 7 cylinders. Jamie McMurray on 7 cylinders, Wally.
Yeah, that, you can tell how fast Mike Wallace was coming up on the 42 car. Jamie's got trouble.
Now the leader in heavy traffic with pressure from behind. Kurt Busch in the 97 out in front.
Oh, he is so loose getting off turn two.
You say tell him not to pass us? Don't pass us. Tell him don't pass us.
Who's that?
Whose radio is that, McMurray's?
Maybe Jamie McMurray's trying to tell Mike Wallace not to pass him, because after all, it's a, hey, here comes the leader. The leader's out of fuel.
There you go.
Kurt Busch diving in for a stop with 8 laps to go. Jeremy Mayfield is out in front. Kurt doing all he could to get the car slowed down by the commitment line and the pit road speed limit. His chance to win is over.
Okay, now, is that enough for McMurray?
Marty?
He's in. They're going to give him a little bit of fuel. The fuel gauge did flutter for Kurt Busch. Very quick stop. Enough fuel to make it to the end, but he will not win tonight.
Boy, oh boy. Hang on. This is going to get topsy-turvy.
Here comes Mayfield. He goes by, puts Kurt Busch a lap down.
Now, is Wallace the position, though, that's keeping McMurray out?
McMurray is basically got a hope that something happened, that Ryan Newman runs out of gas, I think.
I think so, yeah. If Ryan Newman makes it all day, I think Jamie McMurray is going to miss it.
McMurray right now is in 8th place. Newman is in 20th. And Newman has, check this, 11 points on McMurray.
Okay, because, well, Biffle's going to pass McMurray here in about 3 laps. I didn't know if it was that close or not.
Jamie McMurray running in 8th. Mike Wallace has got
five. Reno said we don't need the spot, so he's not giving it to us. Sure do need it.
He needs everyone he can get. See, Greg Biffle, a 16 car, trying to get by McMurray. And it should be easy enough on 7 cylinders.
Yeah.
Boy, does he go through the corners, though.
Boy, there's a frustrated driver in that 42 car. I mean, you're just heartbroken right now, knowing that
You just missed your opportunity. Marty.
Wally Chip Ganassi adamant on the radio, telling the 09 car to help Jamie McMurray out, screaming on the radio. They've sent an official or one of the representatives from the team down to the 09 pit. That is partially a Ganassi car. He wants them to help the 42 out, trying everything they can to keep him in the chase.
Well, that's why I was asking, because that I knew that if that was the position, that the 09 may pull over and give McMurray the spot.
The 09 car owned by James Finch. James Finch runs the number one NASCAR Busch Series team that a lot of the Ganassi drivers drive. They get their power from the Ganassi team in the Busch Series.
Are we getting down to it? White flag. White flag, and Ryan Newman takes the white flag.
Mayfield looking for the win. Who's going to have enough fuel to make the final lap? Bobby Labonte is off the pace on the back straightaway a little bit, getting passed by a few cars. Here comes Jeremy Mayfield. He wins the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. Bobby Labonte coasts across the finish line, and Ryan Newman makes it to the checkered flag and in to the chase for the Nextel Cup.
Whew. Man. It looks like Jamie McMurray is going to miss it by 15 points.
Ryan Newman is in, and Mayfield did everything he had to do.
Jeremy Mayfield led the most laps tonight, 151 of the 400 laps. And Ryan Newman, with a 20th place finish, is going to squeak into the chase for the Nextel Cup. Mayfield with his first victory since the Pocono race in June of 2000.
And there we see, these are the 10 drivers that will go to Loudon next weekend, starting the battle for the NASCAR Nextel Cup. You see Ryan Newman.
All right, Martin got in.
Martin's in.
Mayfield in with his win tonight. And now, the guys left out.
Man. Casey Kane, McMurray, Bobby Labonte.
And they were in and out all night. Those guys, it changed a bunch tonight during this race.
Two things turned this race inside out. The big wreck. The big wreck caught up Jimmy Johnson. And then the caution that came out at lap 293 after a lot of the guys had made green flag pit stops, but Dale Jr. had not.
And where Jeff Gordon, that really moved Jeff Gordon up to the front, which took that 400-point margin away.
Here's a 48 car coming down to get in line. One of the 10 cars that has qualified.
NASCAR is sorting through which 10 drivers have made the chase. They're going to a special impound area to be part of a post-race ceremony and other assorted things like technical inspection. So they've stopped all the cars out there in turn three to try and pick the guys out who've made the chase.
I want to see him put a template on that 48 car and say it's okay.
Kurt Busch,
little unhappy.
Wound up finishing 15th tonight. He's in the chase for the Nextel Cup, but a potential race win went away in the closing laps.
But you want to win. We have a car that's good. You want to win. Boy, there are some happy guys.
Marty.
Jamie McMurray just asking me where you ended up. You ended up ninth, but you're out of the chase for the championship, Jamie.
Yeah, motor blew up again. I mean, it's about the fifth time this year, and been quick enough. Just too bad those guys work really hard, and not a whole lot more we can do about it. We struggled. Donnie made some good calls in the pits, and we got back up in the top 10, and then blew up with like 25 to go. So that's the way it goes.
It looked like for a moment that you were in, though, because you were in the top 10, and it looked like you were going to make the chase.
Yeah, I mean, what are you going to do? I mean, we really don't deserve to be in that right now. The way we finished in the top 10 a lot, and we've raced well enough, but it just broke too many times, too many DNFs, and that's what that deal's based on, is being consistent, and we certainly haven't been that.
Very upset. He finishes ninth in the race, 11th in the championship, Dave.
Walking with Casey Kane now, who finished 24th tonight. Casey, you're 12th, not quite in tonight. What are the emotions?
We just didn't do good enough. Too many problems all night long. Just a pretty pathetic race car.
Could you do anything inside the car to try to get your... I mean, I'm sure you did all night.
Yeah, I tried whatever I could. I tried messing with the brake bias and doing whatever. It didn't help, but we got spun out there during the race either, so it was a bad day.
Tough night for a young rookie, guys.
Well, those are the guys who are not happy. Someone who's going to be smiling from ear to ear is in victory lane.
And Jeremy Mayfield has just pulled into victory lane and is about to climb on out and celebrate his first win in a long, long time. And this is big. I talked to his car owner, Ray Evernham, last week before the race at California. He said he believed they had to get it done last week. And when they didn't, they put the focus on Richmond. And Jeremy Mayfield has raced his way back to victory lane and into the chase for the Nextel Cup. There are high fives and handshakes and hugs. That's Ray Evernham, his car owner. You can't believe it? What can't you believe?
Man, what a night, you know. This whole 19 team. Everybody, y'all.
You know these guys?
I knew it's going to happen. Everyone is going to be big, and it's going to be big. Hey, buddy.
Great job.
Crew Chief Kenny Francis.
Guys, best team I've ever been with. Mary, come here. My car owner. Can't believe I don't know what to say. You know, I knew we had a good car. Afraid that caution would have got us in trouble and kept fighting our way back. And here we are, victory lane.
And you raced the 97 pretty hard. Did they tell you they thought there might be a fuel issue there?
Well, I heard they might, but I wasn't sure. You know, I knew that 10 to go. Kenny's 10 to go. That's all I had. You know, we... just a great car. I mean, all the Dodge dealers out there, UAW, Siemens, Valvoline, everybody that's been a part of this deal that when we were down, stuck with us, now we're back. Can't believe it. Just unbelievable. Mountain Dew's awesome.
It was just about a year.
Fix my hat and I'll be all right.
Okay. There was just about a year ago when people had you out of this car, Jeremy, and you guys got it together and stuck together.
Can't believe it. You know, 1 year ago, like you said, wasn't even going to be here, you know, and kept fighting our way back. This is the toughest bunch of group of guys I've ever seen. All the guys at the shop stuck with me and just kept believing in me. And what? I mean, that's what we had to do. Come here, lead all the laps, win the race. These guys don't let me down. I love them.
Beginning next week, you race for the Nextel Cup.
And I can't believe that. You know, that's our. We come in this week after the last couple weeks, we had some bad weeks. And come in this week just wanted it so bad. And we said, never going to give up. Race that behind us, you know, kept us pumped up, and here we come. We got to run for the championship, top 10 points, one race, don't get no better.
I think the party's out in Owensboro.
My mom, dad, everybody at home, we did it. Party is Owensboro, North Carolina, Tennessee, or where we're from, though.
Jeremy Mayfield wins in Richmond, Dave.
Yeah! As the cheers go on, Bill, back in the garage area, more guys who did not make the chase. Bobby Labonte, 13th in points at the end of this race, a 16th place car tonight, Bobby. How tough was that?
Well, I mean, I think we had a better car than that a lot for most part of the race. Just the way the caution flags fell and we got lapped down and, you know, we were running, you know, pretty good there. And, you know, it's just so hard to pass, you know, saw that for the past three nights in a row here. I hate it for all the guys. I mean, I think we got a great race team. We just didn't be able to prove it in the last, you know, six, seven races to rebound from what we had a few weeks ago. And, just hate it for all our sponsors, all the guys that work on the car, everybody, Joe Gibbs Racing, you know, we definitely tried, you know, we just didn't do a good enough job as a race team. But, there's a lot of worse things in the world than, you know, this right now. So it stinks, but at the same time, you know, we'll go on to Loudoun and, you know, we got to look forward to finish 11th, I guess, at this point in time. So we'll just do the best we can and see what we got. Again, I think the big thing that I like about it is we got a great race team and, you know, I think we ran better tonight. Wasn't quite an aero-sensitive track like they have been going to. That's struggling for me. So maybe we'll fix those places and get better at them that we weren't good at before and finish 11th.
A little perspective from the champion of 4 years ago. Marty?
Dave, walking back to the hauler with Kevin Harvick, who finishes 12th tonight, and wanting to get a seat away from everybody. That was a hard-fought 12th place finish for you guys, Kevin.
Yeah, I mean, car was good early. We just got a little bit loose there under braking. Second half of the race and just couldn't get in a corner. But all in all, it wasn't a bad night for the Jim Gooner Chevrolet. Did the best we could, and that's all I can ask for.
Were you aware of the point situation all night long, Kevin, and what you had to do to try and be in it?
I saw the 48 wreck, so I knew our chances were a lot better than they were when the race started. So knew it, but just did what we could, and that's it.
Fairly calm, Kevin Harvick, 14th in the championship standings now, Alan.
So here are the drivers who will race for the NASCAR Nextel Cup over the final 10 races and the standings after tonight's race in Richmond. Jeremy Mayfield moving up five positions with his victory tonight in this race. Who have not made the top 10 cut tonight. Minutes ago, Marty Snyder spoke with Dale Jarrett, who wind up 15th.
Dale Jarrett, what a dejected moment, but you fought so hard to get a 15th place finish tonight, DJ.
We looked like we weren't prepared for that. Ran terrible, just terrible. So not much you can say. We weren't ready to get what we needed to get.
You had some words with Jimmy Spencer. Were you upset with him?
No, I was apologizing because I ran into him over there and I was just out of control.
All right, Dale Jarrett obviously upset. Out of the chase for the championship. He finishes 15th in the race, 15th in points right now.
Yeah, it's just not a good night for Dale. They just could not get that car to drive. And we talked about a couple of times. He was driving all he could to try and do something with it, but it wasn't working. Lots more to come from Richmond. We'll talk to all of the drivers in the chase for the next L Cup beginning when we come back. The chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship preview show is brought to you by
Matt Kenseth and all these guys. You know what? It's next week.
All right, let's start with the number 10 driver, Ryan Newman. Marty Snyder's with him.
And he's debriefing with car owner Roger Penske. And you're in, officially. You said you didn't want to know until you heard the official word. But you're officially in. Congratulations. Walk me through your night, and how close were you on fuel at the end there?
Just the whole layout of the race was so instrumental for us. Having to pit under green got us way behind. And the Alltel Dodge guys just fought back. And just got to thank everybody at Alltel Mobile, Sony, and Dodge for all their support all year. Do our best job we can for on these next 10 races, but definitely close. And don't even know what emotions I should feel right now. It's just I don't know. We'll kick it in high gear, I guess.
Aren't you somewhat relieved though?
I guess in a way, yeah. But I mean, it seems like kind of drab down here. I mean, everybody's just kind of walking around doing their thing like they're getting ready to go home. But it's I guess a big day for us, and we worked really hard all year to get to this point. Not the point we want to be in, but give us a good opportunity, and we'll try to make the best of it.
Size up how your race team has been in the last few weeks, and do you feel like you're in a position to make a run for the championship, Ryan?
I guess we are, being 10th. I mean, that's all I can say. I just put our best foot forward and go on and see what we can do to attack.
Let's bring in your car owner, Roger Penske. And how nerve-wracking was it to watch up there from the spotter stand tonight, Roger?
Well, I didn't really know where we were, but I knew that Matt was so cool on the radio and just telling Ryan to save a little bit of fuel there, that hopefully we were in good shape. But these guys did a great job these last three races, and they deserve to be in. We're in 10th. We'd like to maybe have been first, but 10 races to go now. We'll see what happens.
Month and a half ago, things weren't going so well for the 12 team. Talk about the rally they've had in the last few weeks. They've been awfully good, haven't they?
Well, this is a great team. We've showed it before, and I think that they put a knuckle down here the last three races and delivered what we needed. So again, great opportunity for us to be in the top 10.
Congratulations, Ryan.
Thanks. It's just TNT. We're trying to build a little drama.
We're building a little drama, as he says, Dave.
Well, Mark Martin's been building drama over the last few weeks here. In fact, Mark, just a few short races ago, you counted you and your team out of this deal. Congratulations on a top five and getting yourself in.
Man, I had to have a drink of Gatorade after that was over with. That's the hardest thing I've ever done in my life. And I want to thank Pat Tryson and the Viagra team, Ford and Kraft Foods, and all Pennzoil, all the folks that support us here, because we're in the hunt now.
How tough was it getting through that wreck out there?
I guess I got lucky. Yeah, a little Joey Chitwood going on there. But, it was meant to be. We didn't run as well as we hoped to, but we sure did race hard. Man, we raced our guts out today. And we have a great race team, and they deserve to be in the hunt. And they're in now. I'm so proud of them.
I noticed you favoring your left arm, Mark. Was that part of what made it so hard for you tonight?
No, it's just it's hurting now, but the car wasn't quite as good as we had hoped it was going to be, and as it looked like it was going to be, and this seat was just slightly different, and because I was up on the wheel, especially the last 100 laps, I drove harder than I've ever drove to win a race. The car was a little loose, and it just kind of beat me in the ground today, and I'm so glad that this is over with, and we can get back to normal.
Wait a minute, you don't get that much of a break on the top 10 here. You've got to race hard. Is that normal?
You don't have to race like we had to race. We spotted some great competition, several hundred points to get in, and we almost got ourselves excluded from it. And it wasn't because we didn't run good. We have a top five team. From here on, I swear, I think it's going to be a little bit easier. This was the hardest thing I can ever remember doing.
Mark, you will start eighth in the chase for the championship. You'll have some ground to make up on the top seven. Based on what you've seen from your team in the last couple weeks, it's doable, isn't it?
It's doable. We have six racetracks that we should be just incredible at, and then four that we should do okay at. So, you know, it all comes down to luck and some performance. I mean, you saw how the Jeremy Mayfield ran tonight. I mean, unbelievable. They stepped up to the plate big time. And, you know, somebody's either going to have to run like that every week if they have trouble, or somebody's going to have no trouble ever in the last 10. And probably the no trouble guy is going to win out.
One last thing. I noticed reigning cup champion Matt Kenseth came over and said, I told you it'd be all right. You guys talked before the race?
I've been stressing pretty hard. This has been a rough 2 months. We've been testing almost every single week. You know, we've had some mishaps and problems and run so good on the racetrack, but you know, we had to race great race teams all the time too. And you know, the hurricanes, we've weathered two hurricanes and all kinds of stuff, and it's been grueling. And this last week, it's just been murder on me, and I'm going to fly the family home tomorrow, and I'm going to lay down for a while, and we're going to start worrying about it about Sunday night or Monday morning. We're going to go to work on it.
All right, Mark Martin, who has finished second in the championship before, will have yet another opportunity to contend for the cup the next Hell Chase. Weber?
Thanks, Dave. With Jeff Gordon, third on the track, first in the points, and let's just talk about your night, because it went from okay to not so good to what you called it, a championship-winning effort as you crossed the line.
How was that? Was that drama?
That was drama.
It was drama for me. I know that, and this entire team. What a great effort. It really was. I would have never guessed we'd have pulled a third place. We were really a fourth. I don't know what happened to Kurt there at the end, but pulled a third out of it. And just an up-and-down night, and luckily, the best the car was the beginning and the end. So we really fought back, but between wrecks happening in front of me and the car going away, us losing a lap, and then just making that great comeback there at the beginning of the race, I was like, man, this is going to be a fun night. That thing just drove to the front, and we didn't do anything to it, you know, and it just went completely away, and I'm not exactly sure why. And there at the end, you know, they put a set of tires on, and we luckily stayed on the lead lap by staying out. Robbie made a great call there. We were very fortunate. And then the car was great there at the end, and we drove by some guys. The next thing I know, I'm, you know, fifth, fourth, and then they tell me I'm third at the end. So great night. I hate it for Jimmy that he had that problem. I saw, you know, a lot of stuff happening in front of me, and I thought I was going to be in it right there with him when he went into the grass.
Well, tell me about that. What did you see?
I just saw somebody get sideways, and there were just a bunch of cars all stacked up, and you know, I dove to the bottom, and Jimmy was in front of me, and I was on the brakes, and the car wasn't slowing down. I was sliding right towards him, and luckily he spun out of the way right as I got there, and you know, we lost some track position because we came in and changed tires, and our night just, you know, got more and more interesting from there until the end.
Obviously, you're chasing a fifth championship. That drive resumes or begins, depending on how you look at it, next week.
Yeah, it does. And we just tested in New Hampshire. We're excited about these last 10 races. That kind of effort that we had tonight is one we're going to put out every weekend for the next 10 weeks. And if that doesn't get it done, you know, the other guys can have it. But we're not going to give up with this thing, you know, on this thing without a fight. Drive for five is on, baby.
Good luck. We'll see you in New Hampshire.
All right. Thank you.
Jeff Gordon goes to New Hampshire as the championship leader, looking for his fifth championship in this sport. Teammates Kurt Busch and Mark Martin, two other guys, along with Tony Stewart, that will be racing for the Nextel Cup this season.
The chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship preview show is brought to you by Nextel, coast-to-coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. Wild night at Richmond, and we continue to meet with some of the drivers who qualified for the championship chase. Matty?
Dale Earnhardt Jr., a hard-fought second-place finish. Looking at that mean-looking race car, you never would have thought that car would have had a chance to win, let alone finish second.
Yeah, it was a pretty interesting race, but I think I just got the bumper put to me by the producers more in the post-race than I did out on the racetrack. But
we're saving the best for last.
I reckon so. anyways, the car, I'm just kidding. The car was good.
Got a couple wrecks out there, tore my car up.
Tore it up? The thing was up in the air.
Yeah, it was up in the air. I'd have liked to have had a few more scratches for all the work we had to do to get back to second, but we got lucky, too, on the pit stop strategy with the gas mileage and a bunch of guys having a pit. But luck counts in this sport, and we took advantage of it and come home second. So I'm real proud of my team.
Now, looking at that race car, some of those dings and dents, you had a little contact with the 9 car, Casey Kane.
Oh, yeah. I went in the corner to go around the outside of him, and he was slow and backing up and in the way, and we went in the corner, and he didn't stay on the bottom. He just kind of backed into the headlight, basically. But I didn't want to spin him out. I ain't got nothing against that boy. Me and him are pretty good friends. He came in the bus a couple times this weekend. We're friends, you know, so I ain't got no reason to spin him out. I don't spin people out for the hell of it, but I do it on purpose when I mean to. So, you know, hate to happen, but, you know, he wasn't having too good a night anyway, so hopefully he ain't too mad at me.
Well, race 26 is in the books. Now we're starting the final 10. Let's look ahead at New Hampshire. Size up your final 10 races. Do you like the racetracks for Dale Earnhardt Jr.?
Well, you know, if you look back over the last several weeks, you know, we're hot and cold. We got to fix that. But like you noted earlier in a conversation with me, that we're really good the last third of the season over the last 4 years. And we're coming up on some tracks that I like, you know, and tracks we do well at. We got to get better at Kansas Homestead. We're going to test hard there. We're going to test at Dover. We're slipping a little bit there. We're going to Martinsville to try to figure out how to finish first instead of third every time. And if we do that and get it right, we'll get it right and we'll win the championship.
Now, we talked back in Daytona, and you had a lot of goals for this race team. One was to chase and win the championship, but also you wanted to rack up a number of wins, and 5 was your total that you really wanted to get.
Yeah, I thought, man, you know, this little voice on my shoulder was saying, man, are you crazy, 5 wins? But we're close, you know, and Matt had a terrible year 1 year, but won 5 races, and I said, Matt, man, you won 5 dang races. How can you be so miserable? And he says, how you ran everywhere else, it really brings you down. And that's what this sport is, you know. You go to Bristol and you're high and mighty and you're kicking everybody's butt, and then you go to California and you get it handed to you. And it's tough, but this weekend was a good race weekend for us. We got some points and finished off real good the regular season, so to speak. And if we get another win, I'll be pretty proud of my team. If we win the championship, I don't know if words will be to describe how I feel about it.
Now, when the season began, a lot of teams planned out their test for later in the season. How many do you have left and where?
We're going to Dover next Tuesday for a day, and we're going to Martinsville for a day. We're going to Kansas for 2 days, Homestead for 2 days. So
I can't believe you remember where you're going.
Well, I mean, we're buckling down. I care, but, you know, we just really want to finish off good. We want to go and work it out and figure out how to get fast at those places, and, you know, we'll just we're going to work hard, you know. If we lose, it ain't by short effort, so we're going to give it all we got. And just like tonight, we followed all we could fight.
If you break his season down into thirds over the past 2 years, his best part, the final third, his average finish, 11th. Marty?
Matt, in the what they're calling the bullpen, where the rest of the drivers are, with Kurt Busch, who finishes 15th tonight, solidly 7th in the chase for the championship. Let's talk about your night. You arguably had the fastest car tonight, Kurt, and then ran out of fuel. Talk to me about that.
Just a great day for our car. The Irwin Industrial Tools team did well. We've run well at these style of tracks, and it's like going and swinging at the bottom of the ninth and getting an 0-2 count and then striking out looking. We just didn't put it together. I miscommunicated what Jimmy Fenning told me. He said we'd be 18 laps shy if we pitted, and I may have made up the if we pitted part. So it was something where we just weren't on the same page, and we stayed out. And who would have thought it would have went green for the rest of the way? But just an awesome race car. We had that same style of car here in the spring at Richmond. We took it to Loudon. We've won there. But it's just a whole new program now. It might have been a 2-horse race or a 4-horse race, and now we've got a whole new fresh outlook on what we've got to do to try to run for this championship. And we're testing a bunch. And just a night like tonight, it's okay to have. It's just kind of a mulligan. You throw it away, and now we've got a fresh start on things. And when the sun comes up tomorrow, we can smile. We know we're in. It's time to go to work.
Early on, you wanted to know if you were in or not. Did that change the way you approached the race after you knew that you were clinched?
It was good just to have a few cars out and know that the worst we could finish was 40th. We led a lap, so that had given us an extra spot or so. But then I saw the 48 wrinkled up, and I thought that'd invite more guys in. And that's something you want. You want competition to be in, but I think you only want to select few. And the 10 that we've got are phenomenal racers. There's no way that you could have picked a better 10. All of us have been running strong, whether it's short tracks, big tracks, the restrictor plate race we're going to have at Talladega. Who knows who's going to be the guy to beat? And now we've got a fresh slate And the team with the open mind is really going to excel at this battle, just being able to work through their tests, not worry about the stopwatch speed, but worry about their car's handling and how it feels to the driver.
I think the boys in the booth wanted to jump in here and talk to you about tonight's race as well.
Hey, Kurt, this is Wally. I mean, we know how this is, highs and lows, this business, and I know how frustrated you were after this race, but you've got to be pumped. You guys have had great race cars here of late, especially like tonight. You got to be pumped for the next 10 races on how your guys' cars have been.
Yeah, we're hitting on the setups. We're making contact with the right things in the pit area, such as making contact with the ball out on the field. We know we're doing things right. Now it's a matter of doing things differently in these final 10. And what I mean by that is just hitting on all cylinders. We've got 8 of them. We need to use them. We've got our tests. We need to use them properly. And it's just a matter of communicating the right way and understanding that it's 18 laps before you pit or you don't pit. And if 1 pound of air pressure is the right way to go when we're putting air in the tire for a pit stop change. So we've got a lot of work ahead of us, but I think we're a team that can compete for this. We're right there with our teammate, Matt Kenseth. The two of us are sharing great information, and I congratulate Mark Martin for getting in. I know how nervous he's been all along trying to get into this chase for the Cup, but it's a fresh race now. We've got a whole new look on things, and we've got Loudon that we won at for the first race, so that gives us big momentum. We could be leading the points coming out of there. But then we've got the mile and a half, and I think those are going to be the key races with Kansas, with Charlotte, Atlanta, and Miami all in there, and I think those are all four tests for us.
And, Kurt, as good as this car was tonight, it was really the second choice. The first choice is going to Loudon next week.
Yeah, you're exactly right, Benny. We thought tonight that we'd be locked in if we made the start, and so we made that prediction at the beginning of the week just to save that chassis number. So that chassis number, this was its sister car. This would have been the backup, and it'll be the backup next week at Loudon. So we've got great cars. Now we just need to go make sure we test the right way. So we've got good cars for those tracks, good cars for these tracks. We just need to polish up on them. And we know that there's going to be a couple of the crapshoot races in there like Talladega and Martinsville. And that's where we see the ups and downs that we have to avoid.
Can you think of a better place to start the chase than New Hampshire, where you won in, what was it, July?
I mean, there's better places and there's more places that we could involve in this chase for the Cup, and I see it changing over the years. Whether we started at California under the lights in upcoming years, next year we're going to have Texas added in, which will be a high-speed, fast track, another mile and a half. And then Bristol might be invited in. So we don't know which tracks we're going to have to run in the future, but this season we've got Loudon, New Hampshire to start in, and it's kind of like going up to Fenway and starting a 7-game series. We've got to be on our game and go up there knowing that we've got the upper hand and that we can do it.
All right, we just saw Kurt Busch's wins this year, Bristol, New Hampshire. He's had a very successful season. He's in the chase, 7th in the points.
And Alan, he's all over that baseball thing. I like when somebody mentions Fenway on one of my race shows, you know? There are the 10 drivers who will compete for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship. Tony Stewart, when we come back to Richmond, Virginia on TNT.
Definitely not.
Back here at the Richmond International Raceway, continuing our post-race coverage following the Chevy Rock and Roll 400, down here with Tony Stewart. 19th tonight, and not an overwhelming evening for you.
No, not at all. This is not the night the Home Depot team wanted, but you know, it wasn't for a lack of effort. I mean, Zippy, poor Zippy, I mean, he's about half dead in the trailer right now. He's been sick all weekend, and you know, for him to have to dig like he did this weekend. And, you know, we just got caught on that sequence of pit stops where, you know, guys pitted after the accident and a bunch of us stayed out. We just got caught under that and, you know, had to race hard to try to stay on the lead lap. But, you know, it just wasn't the night we were looking for. We never got the car where we wanted it. And it wasn't terrible, but, you know, this place, if you looked on the timesheets, everybody was so close that if you were a little bit off, you were way off. So it just wasn't the night we were looking for.
Yeah, that's something that happens here because the guys that are up front are so strong. If you're off just a tick, man, you're in trouble.
Yeah, but that's what makes winning at Richmond so much fun is, you know, the nights that you win here are the nights that you had a car that was 100% right on the money. So, you know, it makes you appreciate those nights that you do have good nights here, but it makes it very frustrating on nights that you're a little bit off and know that it's going to be a lot at the end.
You've got one championship, and now you have a chance to win another. Your thoughts looking ahead to the final 10 races?
We got a lot of work to do, but, you know, that's the great thing about our Home Depot team. It's just like, you know, the relief efforts. We got a bunch of Home Depot associates that are down there, you know, helping rebuild Florida and helping try to protect the people that are staying down there. But, you know, that's just the way our race team is, too. I mean, we never quit. These guys will dig deeper than they've ever dug before to try to get us where we need to be for these last 10 weeks. But it's going to be tough. I mean, you're not going to be able to slip. You're not going to be able to have nights like we had tonight. and think that you're going to win a championship because this group's too tough.
Well, if you think it's been a tough night so far, now the booth guys get to jump in and start asking questions. So hang on.
Hey, Tony, you guys are so good at the last part of the season. Is there a racetrack coming up in the last 10 that you'll be relieved once it's done? I mean, you worry about one of the tracks coming up out of the last 10?
Probably Talladega.
That's what I thought.
I'm sure that's probably been a common response from a lot of people tonight. But, you look at Dover, Loudoun, we've, typically ran well at those two tracks. Homestead, we've ran well at. Atlanta. Phoenix, we've gone well at times. So, realistically, I mean, I'm looking forward to all the races. But, like I said earlier, we're missing something in our program. We don't know what it is. We've been testing a lot. We went to Milwaukee and tested Nashville and tested, trying to find what the variable is in the equation that we need. And we're just struggling trying to find it right now. But, we got a great group of guys at Joe Gibbs Racing and everybody on the Home Depot team. They're going to work as hard as they can to figure out what that variable is so we can be good these last 10 weeks.
Bobby Labonte, your teammate, also has been struggling, Tony. Is it basically the same problems you and he both are having?
Well, to be fair to Bobby, I think a lot of it is, having a crew chief shuffle in the middle of the season like that. That's not the easiest adjustment. And, he's got a great group of guys that are working for him right now, not to take anything away from those guys. But it is a transition when you work with a different group of people and different guys that are making decisions than what you're used to. So, I know it's been a hard probably 2 months for him, but, we'll regroup and we'll have him on top of his game again next year just like normal.
Tony, I'm curious, your comments a minute ago about having an off night. Are you one of the guys that subscribes to the theory that one bad race in these 10 and you're done?
Yeah, I am actually. I'm a multi-subscriber to that theory. you just aren't going to be able to have a bad night. I mean, you look at the competition in this series, and you look at the guys that made the top 10. These are guys that are very capable of putting together strings of top five finishes for 6-8 weeks at a time. So, if you have one bad night where you finish 38th to 43rd, it realistically easily could take you out of a chance at finishing in the top three spots in the points, let alone the opportunity to win a championship here.
I know you're proud of your sponsor. Just want to get one thing in real quick. Last week you saluted the Port Charlotte Home Depot, and this week I believe it was the Fort Myers store, and those people have worked very hard.
Yeah, they really have. I tell you what, it's staggering each day. I mean, the load of plywood comes into Home Depot, and it's gone in the first hour that the store is open. So it's pretty devastating down there, but it's really neat to see how many of the store associates from different stores have gone down to Florida stores and putting themselves in danger just to try to help as many people that have homes down there as possible. So from everybody at Joe Gibbs Racing and myself, I mean, we're just so proud of the Home Depot associates that are doing all that work for us.
Thanks for your time. Good luck in your chase for the next Talk Out.
Thank you.
David?
Standing by with Elliott Sadler, who last year in the championship finished 22nd. This year they turn it around and you get to contend. How does that feel?
Man, it's kind of hard to put in words what it feels like. It's my first time getting to run for a championship. It's the first time my sponsors actually got to run for a championship. So they were all here tonight bagging me up and kind of wishing us good luck for the next 10 weeks.
They were doing what to you?
Wishing me good luck.
Bagging you up?
Wishing me good luck, bagging me up, getting us fired up.
That's what I wasn't familiar with.
getting us fired up for the next 10 weeks. I mean, we feel like we're ready to go. I mean, coming off a win last week, I got the winningest crew chief in the garage. I got the best pit crew on pit road. And, man, we're fired up. We think if we can be consistent like we have been all year long, that we can be the sleeper in this thing.
Let's talk about last week. You guys win at California. Premium time to put a W up there.
It was, and that's the best way to clinch a championship clinch the berth, the chase for the championship is getting a win. I mean, that's unbelievable. It was cool for, we had a lot of M&M's people there, and to do it with the win, to do it in style like that was great to show everybody this team is still in stride. The last 2 months, we've done really, really good. We've been very consistent. We're still the only team right now in the sport with no DNS, and we want to continue that that progress all the way throughout the end of the season. We think if we can do that in the last 10 races, run every lap, average about a 10th, 11th place finish, we can definitely be getting that check when we get to New York this winter. And that's what we want to do. That's the style of racing that we're going to try to race. And we're going to carry the best car we got every week. So no more saving. And we'll see what happens.
Tonight, to get into the chase, you only had to start. I mean, did you have some people trying to lock you in the bathroom or do anything to keep you from starting the race?
No, nobody did anything bad to me. I know Bill Ware. I was pretty mad at Bill Ware, but he didn't have me up where I needed to be at the beginning of the race when we did y'all's little pre-race discovery countdown to green. I wanted to be up clinching, but it's pretty cool when we took the green flag. Todd and all the guys congratulated me and the whole team on a to get a spot to race for the championship. So tonight was fun, man. This week has been great. I've got to spend it in Virginia with a lot of family and friends. It's been so relaxed. I've been racing for 22 years, whether it's go-karts or late models or something. I've never been able to race anything where points was not involved. You know, points don't matter tonight. We're just going to race hard, take some chances, and we did. It bit us when the caution came out, but it's the most fun I've had in a race car in a long time.
Well, Elliott's done a lot to help his chances here. In fact, he played golf this morning, his other passion, did very well. He's going to play again tomorrow, Alan, so keeping up both passions for Elliott Sadler, and he's in the chase.
He's been in the top 10 in the championship standings the entire season so far. That man led the championship starting the night tonight. He'll enter the chase for the Nextel Cup championship, second to Jeff Gordon. We hear from Jimmy Johnson when TNT returns to the Richmond International Raceway. Out of the way. Richmond International Raceway now emptying of fans. The competitors still loading their equipment in the garage, and those who qualified for the NASCAR Nextel Cup chase for the championship are still down in the bullpen, as they're calling it, and talking with you, Marty.
Jimmy Johnson debriefing with Jeff Gordon on what was undoubtedly a frustrating evening for you, Jimmy.
Oh, without a doubt. I mean, luckily it was, tonight and not next weekend. And hopefully, you know, you guys will use their heads and you won't have lap cars crashing and taking out points leaders and, guys running, third, fourth, and fifth in the race. But, you know, it's how it goes. You've got a lot of bullets to dodge when you're out there in the sport. And in this final 10, something like this is going to determine the championship. Some bad luck, some racing luck. It's going to be a major factor when you have tracks like Talladega, Martinsville, even Loudon. So it's going to be exciting. It's going to be stressful on all of us, but it's going to be good for the fans. I just hope that the Los Monte Carlo and this team can stick together as we have, and we should be fine. We'll be in good shape.
Yeah, 36 tonight, and I've got to ask you, four of the last six races, 36 or worse. That concern you at all, even though a lot of those were not your fault?
I mean, you always want to have, the momentum rolling in the right direction. But with those finishes, we've had, a lot of bad luck that we can chalk up as something else. So, our speed and performance has been there. We've just had some bad luck. And, might as well get it all out of the way now so we can start over with a clean sheet of paper next weekend and take it from there.
That's a good point. They got it all out of the way now, and they're going to New Hampshire next week where they won both of the races last year, Alan.
Jimmy Johnson has been in the top two in the championship standing since Talladega mid-April. He's got to hold that for 10 more weeks. Matt Kenseth, when we come back. It's the chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship preview show. We finished race 26, now 10 races starting next Sunday in Loudon, New Hampshire, to determine which of these 10 drivers will be your 2004 Nextel Cup Series champion. Trying to stage the photo of the 10 drivers. The photographer is obviously disagreeing with the choreography. With that ongoing down in the bullpen area, just between the racetrack and the pit road.
Everybody good?
Matt Kenseth and Jeremy Mayfield, the two of the top 10 we haven't heard from yet as far as the championship is concerned. So let's take this break while they do the photo, and we'll hear from Matt and Jeremy after this. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. The chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship is on. And those are the 10 drivers who will compete for the 2004 crown. Jeremy Mayfield with a win, moving up five places tonight to secure his place in the chase. Matt Kenseth has been in the top five in the championship since winning the second race of the season in Rockingham, North Carolina. What a year it's been for Matt. Let's hear from him now.
And he had clinched before coming to tonight's race, and almost good news the way your night transpired.
Yeah, it was a mess. We had a great car, which was a good news. Our DeWalt car ran, really awesome all night on long runs. We started the race terrible. We actually pitted on lap 9 or something to work on it, and Robbie made some great adjustments, and we did good up until we pit under green and left the wrench in the back, and that took away our chance for victory. But before that, we had a great car. We just caught Jeremy for the lead, just got around him, and we had that trouble and lost a couple laps. That kind of put us in for the night.
End of the year trying to win back-to-back championships. Do you like the way this team is sitting right now with 10 to go?
Well, yes and no. I mean, we've got a great team. It's the same group of people. They know they can do it. We just have to, all of us, including myself, we just have to apply ourselves. Can't make mental mistakes like we made tonight, and can't be inconsistent on pit road like we were last week. We got to put it together and not make mistakes. And, we got to go out and want to win this thing and work hard at it and not make mistakes. And, we're plenty capable of doing it. We just got to put it all together and do it.
2 points wins, 1 non-points win. Do you feel like the driver that's going to win the championship is going to be a guy that's going to go out and dominate and knock down some wins, or the guy who's going to go fourth, fifth, and sixth?
both. I mean, it's going to be the guy who can win races and can lead laps and get the most points that way. And it's also going to be the guy that doesn't make a mistake, you know, when he's having an off day. You know, when he's got a 10th place car and he brings it home 10th, that's what you need to do. You know, you can't have a winning car make mistakes like we did tonight and finish 28th, and you can't have a 10th place car and wreck it and finish in the back either. You know, whatever you have that night, you have to finish, you know, what your car is capable of. It's very competitive. It's hard to get to run up front each and every week. And when you're up front, you got to make sure you get that finish.
Antsy to get started?
Yeah, I guess so. I mean, it's, you know, with 10 races to go, it almost feels like it's the second week of the year just because that's about what the points look like after, you know, 2 or 3 weeks. Everybody's pretty close yet. So, you know, I'm excited to go to Loudon. This is a great track for us. I'm still real disappointed about the night tonight, but I'm excited to go to Loudon and, you know, get it rolling.
The 2003 champ chasing a second title. Guys?
Matt with a 28th place finish tonight after a couple of problems. No problems tonight for Jeremy Mayfield. Picked up the win and got himself a place in the chase. You're watching NASCAR on TNT. We're back to Richmond after this. Post-race coverage here at Richmond International Raceway on TNT after Jeremy Mayfield won the Chevy Rock and Roll 400. He kind of had trouble coming up with the words in victory lane earlier. Let's get his thoughts about being in the championship now that he's had time to think about it some, Dave.
We will ask him that. Alan was just talking about the fact that now you've had a lot of time to think of words to put that you didn't have in victory lane to this whole championship chase. What do you think?
Yeah, you're right. I didn't know what to say. I was just so proud of the guys and everything, and just to be able to be in this, being the last, you know, come to the last race, I guess you say, and step up to the plate like this team did is pretty awesome. And now I feel like we got a good shot as anybody to win the championship. And this thing NASCAR for allowing us this new point system and, you know, allowing us to be able to have a shot at it. It's pretty cool.
Jeremy Mayfield, championship contender by winning here tonight. Alan?
Mayfield led 151 of the 400 laps to pick up his first win of the season. Talk about a clutch performance. That was the one, and that didn't have anything to do with the burnout. The chase for the NASCAR Nextel Cup Championship Preview Show is brought to you by Nextel, coast-to-coast walkie-talkies in under a second. NASCAR and Nextel, partners in speed. And by Chevy, the winningest name in racing, an American Revolution. So with 10 races to go, the point totals of the top 10 are adjusted upward, and that will be what the standings will look like when we wave the green flag in New Hampshire next Sunday.
So Ryan Newman now only 45 points out of first.
And our coverage from New Hampshire begins on TNT Friday at 3 Eastern with Bud Pohl qualifying next Sunday, 12:30 Eastern. The NASCAR Nextel Cup chase for the championship begins. We'll start with Discover Kart Countdown to Green. It's been an exciting night here in Richmond. A lot of twists and turns, and we're just getting started in deciding this thing.